friends and enemies. Hello. Hello. All right. We're going to pick up where we left off. You'll be treated like a special case. You should be glad. You're just abusing your authority, aren't you? After what happened, Ryo did the smart thing and allowed Samajima Saotaro to take him before the police got involved. Officially, Ryo is now under Samajima's supervision, and observe him he did. You know some difficult terms. I'm impressed. What is this place? It's one of the rooms I have. Feel free to use it as you see fit. Don't worry if you dirty the walls. I'll call a cleaner. Why would you lock me up here personally? What are you after? I won't tell you. Until you remember it by yourself. You said something similar last time. Have we actually met in the past? Who knows? Maybe you'll realize something while living here. Wait, where's Midori? What happened to her? Don't worry, she's currently being kept in a special facility. Your mother is nowhere near her. Oh, hi. I hope you're doing well. Ow-woo! Hello. I am rested. My theories have been crafted. I want to see if I'm right. You think I'm just going to believe that? Let me see you right now. Oh, you do realize that the least trustworthy person here is you, right? Brother or not, you committed domestic violence. Little Midori was quite terrified. Merely seeing your face might bring up bad memories. Anyway, I will come again tomorrow. See, Midori. 119, 200. The way Kikuchi Ryo was focusing on nothing but exercise made him look like an actual prisoner. He walked over to the refrigerator and grabbed some mineral water. Phew, enough for push-ups. He sure doesn't look like he has much to do. 199, 200. It hurts to look at him. Oh yeah. Oh? Kikuchi reached into his bag and took out a letter. It was the one he'd received from Suo. I ended up not giving him a reply. Didn't even have time to tell him about this. I wonder if he's still waiting for me. Eh, forget it. It's not like he'd met with someone like me again. He went and crushed the nice-looking letter in his hand. And even if we did meet, I'd probably be unable to look him in the eye. Ryo imagined those pure eyes filling with rejection and dread, then shook his head. He lost his trust and kindness. And all he got in exchange was a mystery man who'd given him warmth in the past and went on to vanish. Huh. What a bother. He covered his face with bony hands as the evening sun shone through the window and onto his back. No changes today either, huh? The day passed and Kikuchi Ryo continued exercising like it had become routine. He showed no intention of looking for a way to escape. Almost as if he knew how meaningless it was. But as he did his thing, he couldn't help but think about the crumpled up letter from Suo. Shit. I should just tear it up and... tear up this pretty little envelope that he must have gotten from a specialty shop, Ryo thought. Would he feel better if he tore it up? He shut his eyes tight. But instead of splitting the paper, he opened it. Ryo, thank you for your letter. You said you were jealous of me, when in truth, I'm the one who looks up to you. Huh. Feeling a piercing pain in his chest, Ryo continued reading. You woke me up and helped me at the sea a whole 2 times now. You're an amazing person. I'm sure you're far greater than you believe yourself to be. But I know you don't realize it yourself. I mean, just look where I ended up. I want you to remember this much, though. No matter what you say, I will always believe in your noble kindness. He's forced to leave it in text, huh? P.S. I still can't forget the taste of the donut you shared with me. Let's go to the sea and eat more donuts there sometime. I want to know what the whole one is like. He sure is cheeky. Put more strength into the hands holding the letter. I'd love some donuts too. Feeling like I had seen his smile for the first time in a while, I couldn't help but break into a smile myself. Glad these two are doing their letter exchange. What are you writing? Samajima Satoru quite enjoyed coming to this apartment and being hit with a glare that could kill. Kikuchi Ryo's gaze was abnormally sharp. It carried a heat that brought excitement back into him every day he returned from work. This day, however, the glare never came, which he found lacking. He saw a look and saw Kikuchi Ryo facing the desk, not telling. As though expecting Samajima's question, the boy made distance between them. I see. Won't you confiscate it? Did you want me to proofread it or something? Sadly, I have no interest in correcting your ideals. Despite saying that, Samajima continued staring at Kikuchi Ryo. After a while, Ryo stopped writing. His side profile was the unique expression of a person pondering how best to express himself. Samajima found it familiar. You're quite like him. Like the children's writer I came to know in that pink house, he thought. Kikuchi Ryo pretended not to hear it. When will we get to meet again? Oh, is that what you want? Of course, she's my precious sister. Oh, so that's who you had in mind. Kikuchi Ryo quickly gave up on getting an answer and returned his gaze to the letter. Samajima wanted to see his name written in this edgy writing. Should I pass it on? Huh? The letter to Suo Kato, I mean. Why would you? I've been acquainted with him for quite a while. He's my boss's son. You expect me to believe that? You're free to believe what you want, but I may even bring you his responses. Well, this doesn't mean I believe you, but... Thank you. The smile growing on Samajima's face contained trust like Kikuchi Ryo had never seen. Hello, starting today, your house arrest is officially over. Huh? The first thing Samajima told him that day left Ryo speechless. Let's celebrate your release with a visit to the amusement park. What about the letter? Well, not like expected much from you, but start by taking me to Midori. Kikuchi Midori is there as well. A celebration must be fine after all. What's the catch? Kato and Osamu are there as well. Why? Samajima's smile grew wider. You wish to see them now? I get Osamu, but Suo has nothing to do with this. He most certainly does. What do you mean? You'll find out when you go there tomorrow, and do try to enjoy yourself. I will be watching. Ryo. Midori. Were you eating well? You weren't scared, were you? I was just fine. What about you? Yeah, I'm fine too. His days were full of stress and he could barely bring himself to eat. However, Midori's warmth completely dispersed his pent-up irritation. Midori, now in his arms, was in a far better state than he'd expected. Samu, over here. Again, it's Uncle Osamu. Oh. Samu. Well, I'm glad you look fine. Enjoy your day, will ya? Were you the one who looked after her? I visited the facility once or twice. Anyway, you hungry? I'll buy you something. I want some ice cream. What, in this cold? Well, don't blame me if it makes your tummy hurt. Chatting, the two walked off toward a stand. The fact that Midori was so close to him made Ryo feel somewhat excluded. She's just fine without me, huh? As he made a dejected sigh, he heard some energetic footsteps coming up from behind him. Quiet. In a corner behind a wall of mirrors, Kikuchi Ryo had his mouth shut by Samajima Satoru's large hand. Don't make too much noise. Remember who's with Kikuchi Midori right now. Are we clear? I'll let you talk now. Plan this? You're with Osamu? Absolutely not, and I would appreciate not being grouped together with him. Suddenly, Satoru pouted like a child and cleared his throat to switch back to his usual self. I don't intend to hurt you. I only wish to talk. He grabbed Kikuchi Ryo's arm so gently it was almost uncomfortable. I like Ferris wheels. Would you ride it with me? He then pulled Ryo by the wrist, taking him to the entrance. Let's go, Ryo. Kikuchi Ryo had no choice but to go along with them. Ferris wheels really are nice, so cozy and lovely. Make some space, our knees are going to touch. I'm sorry, my legs are quite long. Samajima then crossed his legs, closing the distance between their knees even further. With a metallic sound, the cabin began making a circle. soon left the ground and reached a height that would kill a person instantly should they fall out. There was nowhere to run. Look around. The city is so distant. Looking down at it makes it seem almost artificial. Kikuchi Ryo was in no state to enjoy the view. This is so nostalgic. Have you finally remembered? There was a time limit to this torturous experience, as the Ferris wheel would make it turn in 10 odd minutes. All Ryo had to do was keep quiet and put up with it. The cabin shook violently, and the Ferris wheel came to a halt. As Ryo's heartbeat accelerated, the announcement let them know there was some sort of trouble. Oh dear. The oxygen in the air immediately felt heavy and difficult to breathe. He inhaled as hard as he could, but it didn't make breathing any easier. He couldn't open the window either. All he could do was endure shaking while gulping down his saliva. Are you okay? Something could sound like this isn't your fault. My, how scary. This happened at the perfect time. Now I can finally talk to you like myself. Huh? Hmm? Then that unstable cabin. Samajima Satoru slowly stood up.
Ah!
Metallic ceiling made a disquieting sound. Hey, the hell are you? I'm sorry, I just wanted to see you from up close. Ryo felt barely alive, as if the ground itself had been pulled out from under him. His large bent body and long arms placed him in a twofold trap. You cannot escape now. Ryo wanted to shout, but he knew that all too well. I will have you remember what happened in 2003. He wanted to run. I will tell you about the Mamiya within you. But he wasn't allowed to run. The nail that sticks out gets hammered in, but stick out enough and it becomes the standard. That's what I'd finally realized. Odd as it was, even after eating Mamiya's flesh that day, I acquired a leading position in my department. Everyone said they wanted to become like Superintendent Samajima, that he had charisma. Charisma was, at its core, a charm that common people lacked. We are creatures biologically attracted to things we don't have. That's what I gained from that day's madness, and that was it. I decided to curse society, but thanks to Mamiya, I was able to adjust to it and keep it in the palm of my hand. Such irony looking back, there was plenty of that ever since I'd met Mamiya. Was everything that happened caused by the karma surrounding Mamiya? Perhaps, and this particular memory was no different. A body had been found at the construction site. It belonged to Masaki Hashida, a 64-year-old factory worker. I see, and the first witness is? It's a child. The moment Satoru saw the child, Kikuchi Ryo, his muscles tensed up. As he observed him and their eyes met, Satoru was assailed by an intense feeling of deja vu. It was the second time. Twice now have different sensations touched him simultaneously. He'd used his senses for anything off to solve cases many times by now. However, this was the first time he'd felt two off feelings with different causes from the same person. He was just a boy. Satoru realized he was feeling something personal, something unrelated to the case about this child. Felt like he had to realize what it was, otherwise he'd regret it for the rest of his life. The rest of this life. Mamiya? He didn't know what he was saying. After all, Mamiya had returned to the Trikilocosm. You know Mamiya? The question made his heart freeze over. I do. What is your relationship with Mamiya? Satoru kept himself in control. That could have easily been the name of a friend at school. Mamiya is someone important to me. Sweet metallic sound could be heard under the collar of the boy's somewhat oversized clothes. Mamiya helped me. This nostalgic atmosphere was familiar to Satoru. He could almost smell the air of the house where they shared their memories of Mamiya in 1999. Guess I know Mamiya too. No good. Satoru recognized this feeling was no good. Satoru. There was no way he could see Mamiya in this child. Thank you for your cooperation, Kikuchi Ryo. Are you tired? I'm okay. After questioning the boy and taking his fingerprints just in case, Samajima gave him some apple juice. The boy was an odd one. Despite finding a corpse, he'd remained calm as he reported it, and seemed unaffected even now. There were no signs that he'd cried, nor any tells of an acute stress disorder. Then again, perhaps he wasn't showing any symptoms due to being in a state of shock. Satoru felt that he had to see how he would progress and treat him accordingly. Contacted your address several times now, but no one appears to be home just yet. That's fine. It's likely this child was being subjected to something close to domestic violence. You don't have to tell her about this. If you interrupt her at her job, it's going to cause rumors, and I'll get yelled at. Despite being so young, he seemed to understand that if someone was questioned by the police, it could lead to people gossiping about it. The proof was in the fact he was talking quietly and hiding his wounds. I see. Anyway, here's your reward as the first witness. Normally, I would give this to you at your guardian, but if they're not here, it has to go to you. It was a few thousand yen, but that was a lot to a child his age. As a rule, first witnesses have to be visited several times following the initial report. Would you mind meeting me again? As long as you don't come to my house. Are you familiar with the shrine grounds? I propose we meet there next weekend. Kikuchi Ryo nodded. And we should continue our talk about Mamiya as well. The shine in his large eyes gave Satoru his first heartache in a while. Oh yes. The moment he came back home, Satoru collapsed on the sofa and took a deep breath. Mamiya is back. Many days had passed since they ate the flesh and swore to raise a new Mamiya. He was the only one unable to find a child he could turn into Mamiya. No doubt, because unlike theirs, my Mamiya had the appearance of a child. It wasn't that he didn't have any motivation or investment. He simply couldn't find a child worthy of being his Mamiya. But that one, Kikuchi Ryo, he's Mamiya without me having to instill Mamiya in him. Samajima's urge to kill had subsided after he consumed Mamiya's flesh. He was satisfied with just having his dear Mamiya inside him. Rabbits, three of them. Perhaps they're kept on these grounds. Do you know that rabbits are counted as birds sometimes?
Birds?
Yes, indeed. Why, they don't have feathers or anything. Indeed, they don't. Apparently, in the past, the monks of the temples couldn't eat beast meat. That's why they decided that rabbits are birds and ate them. So the theory goes, anyway. They ate rabbits? How sad. You eat cows and pigs yourself, don't you? Why do you feel that way about rabbits? You're right, I wonder why. Because they're cute? How strange. For all you know, the rabbits may want you to eat them. Huh? There's a story that goes like this. A long time ago, there was a rabbit, a fox, and a monkey. One day, the three were gathering food for a tired elder. The monkey brought a fruit, the fox caught a fish, but the rabbit didn't bring anything. That was when the rabbit said, "Eat me," and jumped into the fire, giving itself to the elder. A white rabbit went past Samajima right as he finished the story. It's a moving tale. The creature burned itself for the sake of letting the elder live. It wouldn't have died if it didn't feel like saving the elder. No, the rabbit had no other choice. If it didn't help the elder, it would have regretted it for the rest of its life. Is that worse than death? Most likely. Kuchiro balled his small hands into fists and stopped talking. Satoru felt that he might have scared him a little and tried to make it better. There's a continuation of that story that says the elder was actually a god. God took pity upon the rabbit and put its image on the moon as an example for everyone else. That's why there's a rabbit living on the moon. So the rabbit was happy because it regretted nothing and could become an example to others? I think so, yes. I believe this rabbit is a lot like Mamiya. He also compared himself to the moon quite often. He looked up at the moon in the pale sky. The lunar seas that were said to look like a rabbit had melted into the blue atmosphere and their outline was vague. Mamiya is the monkey that gave the fruit. He's alive, and he's always there. The boy put his hand on his chest, causing the chain peeking through his clothes to gleam and shine. It's a nice accessory you have there. I got it from Mamiya. Can I take a look at it? Must have made him happy to show it off. Ryo removed his necklace with a smile on his face. This is a dog tag. It was a simple one. The only text carved on it was Ryo. Satoru felt like he'd seen something like this before. Mamiya had one. When I said I liked it, he made one for me, too. A strange premonition hit Satoru like a bolt of lightning. He suddenly had trouble breathing. Satoru? Was this child actually Mamiya because someone had already turned him into Mamiya? Could you let me meet your Mamiya? Mamiya. Oh, Ryo, you said you wanted me to meet someone. Yes. I indeed know your Mamiya, Ryo. Three headed to a nearby park in complete silence. Two adult men and a child, what would onlookers think if they saw them? This was Satoru's first time meeting Arasagawa since that day. The swamp-like taste of the years 1999 and 2000 spread across his mouth. Mia, try not to trip. He had aged since their last encounter. No. Arasagawa had become an adult you could rely on, like a father. I didn't expect to meet you through Rio. It's like that time Mamiya pulled us under Tokyo Tower. Mamiya, so you really are the one who instilled Mamiya in Rio. Kikuchi Rio was playing with sand in an abandoned piece of playground equipment. I was quite surprised, you see. When I looked at Kikuchi Rio, I felt like I saw Mamiya himself. If you were the one responsible, it would explain everything. So you also saw Rio as Mamiya? Yes, unmistakably. Thanks. You sound happy. Because I am. My work was conveyed as intended. Satoru had always hated the mocking smile this man would often make. I created that Mamiya after lots and lots of polishing. Weren't you unable to write stories? After putting down the pen in 2000, I had considered what it was that Mamiya needed. But I'm glad you got to confirm it. If you think that's Mamiya, then Nagaki and Bach will likely feel the same way. I finally made it this far. He looked up at the windy sky. Satoru found the expression scary. And how far are you planning to go? The man turned around and smiled with a dirty grin. Who knows? Maybe I should use Rio as the idol in my new religion. I understand now that the child is the Mamiya you created. However, back when I looked at him, I felt there was another thing off about him. It was a common type of deja vu unrelated to any yearning. It was about the dog tag Kikuchi Rio showed off. He is similar to the youth I met at Kato's house in 1999. In the December of 1999, when he was left to take care of his boss's son, Mamiya had vanished shortly after that, so Satoru's memories of him weren't particularly vivid yet. Please help Suo. Suo Kato is a sleepwalker. I can't protect him. That man, shaking desperately as he pled, wasn't that Kikuchi Rio himself? Due to his particular line of work, Satoru was not one to mistake people for others. Normally, one would assume they were siblings or parent and child, yet he couldn't bring himself to dismiss the possibility that they were the same person. But then who is that child? The Count of Saint Germain who appeared in various times? That just makes him seem more like Mamiya. As he reclined on the sofa, he was overtaken by a mix of wonder and curiosity. How would Keita react if I saw him? I haven't talked to him since he told me he bought a new phone. Look, Mr. Samachima, I finally got a phone. Let's exchange numbers then. I can even send you mail. Would it interest you if I told you about this? Oh, that's no good. Showing that child to him could make his sleepwalking flare up again. Maybe I'm worrying too much. A lot of things happened today. I should go to sleep. Satoru hoped he could meet Mamiya again in his dreams. I don't need dreams. I can already meet him anytime I want. Mia exists in this world as Kikuchi Rio. Knowing that Kikuchi Rio was a Mamiya created by Arasagawa Osamu, Satoru couldn't keep himself from wanting to meet him. Thus he insisted they continue meeting at the shrine grounds on his days off. Talking to him made Satoru miss that honeymoon period from the end of the century. It also made him wish that this boy too was immortal. One rabbit. He could pierce his heart with a blade, tear his limbs off. Two rabbits. He could close his screaming mouth as he drowned him in the bath. Three rabbits. Satoru? Yes? You were spacing out. Oh, I was just looking at the dried leaves. My thinking, Satoru thought. Remember your pride as someone who plays by the rules. Still, if all his wishes could come true. No. I will surely go back to normal once I meet Kato. He took out the phone he kept for private calls and clicked on his name in the contact list. Perhaps he had a lecture and couldn't answer. Just as Satoru was thinking of leaving a message. Hello? Pit opened in his stomach. You're not Kato, are you? Did he have the wrong number, or did it belong to someone else now? Satoru hoped, begged that was the case, but... ED. There was only one person in the world who called him by that crude name. Arasagawa. He remained calm, putting on a business-like demeanor. What happened to Kato? And he hoped that this was unrelated. Hey, ED, tell me. He tried to keep his cool, restraining his emotions. Is Ryo a proper Mamiya? Why would he ask that now of all times? Is it pleasant to be with him? Felt as though he could read his mind, but how? Just put Kaito on the phone, or tell me if he's alright. Good to know. Good to know what? Satoru had no idea what was happening there. Suo's with me. His life is in my hands. He's my hostage, basically. Get it? I failed. He's more composed than I am. What do you want? First, there's something I gotta confirm. Who's more important to you, Suo or Mamiya? Why would he ask that? He thought of the young man with the bright smile and that dancing sky blue hair. He was like a mythical creature you could trust with your last ray of hope. Cetera placed him on one side of the scale, the grand moon on the other. Mamiya, shouldn't that be obvious? Yeah, I suppose it is. Suo wasn't enough to outweigh it. I'll give you a location. I want you to come here immediately and don't tell anybody about this. Very well. Pure madness, along with the shadow he'd sworn would never fall on him again, began to overtake him. That's how it went. Do you remember now? Oh, you're unconscious. I suppose I rushed it a little. Up you go. Samajima Satoru picked up Kikuchi Ryo's unconscious body and bent his large frame to get out of the Ferris wheel. He must have been quite tired. Not everyone falls asleep in a Ferris wheel. He left the amusement park with a smile on his face and Kikuchi Ryo in his arms. When will you wake up, I wonder? I should tell him to come pick you up. I just remembered that he's carrying Midori, who's also sleeping. Charming that both brother and sister took an afternoon nap. I will take you to your home then, no need to worry. I will pick you up later. As he was being carried, Kikuchi Ryo was actually somewhat conscious. He could feel the dark clouds above covering the amusement park. He could also feel the atmosphere being heavy with moisture. And he could feel this man handling him more gently than he had expected. Even so, he wasn't able to fully wake up. After all, doing so would cause an immense flood of memories to overwhelm him. Floodgates of the dam he'd been subconsciously maintaining were opened by Samajima Satoru. Placed between memories like compressed earth and lead, he found himself barely able to breathe. Sleep. Sleep. Good boy, sleep tight. All he could hear with his faded consciousness was Samajima's awkward lullaby. So he was a way better boy than someone like me, Ryo thought. Kaito had a bright future ahead of him. Ryo wondered if he'd deserve to survive at his expense. He wondered if everyone's life was of equal value. The next time he awoke, he found himself in his home. He'd been kept under house arrest by Samajima for the past few days. As a result, he felt like it had been quite a while since he last came here. The TV was destroyed and the tableware was scattered all over the place. A damp scent was still permeating there. It's definitely his home, a dreary place indeed. Midori, the dusty box was the one place he belonged in. I want to see her. The oath he'd sworn long ago escaped his dry throat. Ryo, you're a big brother. I am? Within his mother's arms, he saw the monkey-like face of a newborn girl. Cute. It was the birth of his salvation. When he gently touched her soft hair, she took his fingers in her tiny arms. He wanted to protect her. He wanted to do anything for her. He didn't wish for anything but her happiness. Midori, where are you? The roar that echoed through the empty home was almost beauty. Midori, without you, I'm... Kuchi Midori is at my place. Hearing that voice made him raise his face and scowl. Samu. Ryo, I came here for you. Midori's there. He'll get food, too. Let's go back to your new home. Arasagawa Osamu extended his hand, but Ryo pushed it away. No, you're the one who... I'll be the adult to protect you. Tsuoki. Died because of me? Yeah, I killed him. Arasugawa Osamu's warmth embraced Kikuchi Ryo. This body full of strength and vitality felt awfully hot. I killed him with these same hands that protected you. Stop it. His large bony fingers slid over Kikuchi Ryo's wrist. Hold my hand, Ryo. Stop. He wanted to resist, but his overflowing emotions shook him so much he couldn't gather any of his strength. Do you want to get away from me? The callus on his finger, likely made by writing, touched Ryo's wrist. You want to take Midori and leave me? The intense pressure of his fingers went between Ryo's bones. Finally gonna do that? His children without a money or a home? Osamu ran his fingers along Ryo's palm as if reading it. You wanted a father, didn't you? But you killed Suo, and I... Arasugawa Osamu placed Kikuchi Ryo's hand in his own. It looked as though he was rubbing invisible blood onto his palm. Forgive my sin, Ryo. Ryo's back was cold from sweat. Don't forget that you yourself are only alive because of Suo's sacrifice. The cartilage in Ryo's ears was shaking from Osama's voice. It was enough to drive him insane. Stop, please. His rough adult voice then reached his chilled stomach. Let's be a family, Ryo. His hands were closed in Osamu's. Their sweat bound them together, making it impossible to get away. With a gentle warmth, he whispered those decisive words into his ear. We're partners in crime. Hey, Osamu. It's Uncle. Osamu? Yeah, what is it? The camera isn't showing anything. Let's see, you forgot to remove the cover. Huh? Ah, it's not dark anymore. You're having fun with that? I want to take more shots. That's so. Let's go to the park then. You're coming too, right, Ryo? Their life in the new home was safer than the one they had before. Nobody could get mad if Ryo wasn't walking silently, and he could stay calm without keeping the door slightly open. They had a place where the three of them could sit around the same table and enjoy the same food. I got the answer. Wait, hold it, don't say anything, I'm still thinking. You don't know? Matches are... I told you not to say it. Kikuchi Midori was very attached to Arasugawa Osamu. He'd given her a camera. She was very into photography, taught to her by Osamu himself. I actually wanted to make it a bit brighter. Got to adjust the exposure. Here, hold this button and turn the lens. It had been a long time since Ryo had seen Midori having this much fun. For someone so rough, Arasugawa Osamu was very good at dealing with children. He understood Midori and managed to bring out the best in her. It's bright now. See? That should help you take better photos. All Osamu did was show her the door. That was how it had been with Ryo as well. He trusted children as individuals and let them freely walk through it. Watching them and seeing himself in their interactions, Ryo squinted his eyes. Looking back, the reason he got into books and looked for ways to put his feelings into words was so he could better identify his surfacing urges, thus making them at least slightly weaker. No matter what awful things he may have done, Arasugawa Osamu had always been an ally to children. Osamu. What's up, Ryo? Can't sleep? I don't sleep this early, plus I had a night shift. Huh? Doing what? Road maintenance? Yeah. They praised me for having good eyes. Did you want something? Yeah. Sit down, then. Tell me what's been going on in your life. Ryo hesitantly began opening up. He mentioned how he couldn't fit in at school and talked about the seaside park he often went to with Midori, as well as the sneakers he wanted. He still wasn't good at expressing himself, but Arasugawa was an attentive listener who understood him regardless. Ryo wondered if that deep, abundant silence was an adult's expression of love. It was peace, akin to sitting on a boat, drifting along on a still lake. That just made Ryo even more confused. Arasugawa Osamu was the very same person who locked him and Suo Kato up and put Kato through all that violence. It baffled him that he could still remain such a pleasant adult. Was this attachment an expression of aspiration or obligation? Was this cold sweat an expression of fear or love? Ryo's mental dictionary was ill-equipped to properly describe how he felt. The chain on those dog tags is a bit short, isn't it? It's the one you gave me. I never took it off, even after what happened. Neither if I took it off, it'd be as if that day never happened. Actually, I don't really know why. I tried to make myself duller so I wouldn't remember it and get hurt. That so? Got up from the sofa and went to pick up a book before coming back. There's a book I wrote while thinking of you. It was a children's book with the cover showing a cheetah dashing across the wastes. Cheetah is a graceful creature and the fastest in the savannah. It's got strong, beautiful muscles. When I saw you, that's the kind of scenery that came to mind. However, this isn't the savannah, but modern Japan. You're stuck in a small box where you can't use your legs to their fullest and are reduced to sneaking around. The familiarity of the expression made Ryo dig his nails into the back of his hand. I don't know what that was about, but I guess I just wanted to free you from the invisible box surrounding you. Invisible box? And like a glass cage at the zoo. I wanted to see you break stuff like that, leap over it, and run as fast as you could. That's why I wrote a book about it. And I still want to see it. I want to see you discard your envy of ordinary people. It's a feeling much like the attraction I felt to the original you before I did anything to make you a Mamiya. Osamu suddenly took Kikichi Ryo's hands. He then bent forward and brought the hands closer to his forehead. Our perfect Mamiya. Sorry. I'm really sorry. It's okay, though. You can forget all about Mamiya. Rabbit-like hat was swaying behind the man. You were plenty charming without anyone doing anything to turn you into a perfect Mamiya. You don't have to stand out. All that really matters is that you lead a reasonably happy life. A reasonably happy life? Feeling that something was off, he returned to his room and got on the floor. It's because I want the unusual. Be like a cheetah and run free through the wasteland. You are a noble person. What did they all want from me? I was an admirable enough person to answer anyone's expectations. Kikuchi Ryo, you are the focus of so many people's expectations. If there was anything I suggest you do before their weight breaks you, it's... Reading the letter. I stole the letter he got from Suiketo at the amusement park. I want him to not be crushed by his life with Arasagawa Osamu and remember Suiketo. That should cheer him up. And you want me to suggest that? I'm sure you don't like seeing him so down either, so help me with this. Well, I don't mind. I just gotta make him read the letter, right? Amiya agreed more readily than I had expected and approached Kikuchi Ryo. Hey, Ryo, you seem pretty down. Wait, huh? Mia. So I didn't even have to suggest it. You're reading the letter yourself. I'm not. I can't. Why? I'm scared. Huh? If I take the letter, I'll have to respond, right? Cold. It's okay. Don't think I can give him the correct response. Oh no. Why did I survive? If I'd died instead of him, this wouldn't have... Stop you right there. Even though Mamiya stopped him from continuing that thought, Kuchiro merely smiled in self-derision. It's like a tag placed at the very front of my brain. I know I gotta do it, but I postpone it, and instead just look at it every day, which makes my heart ache even more. I mean, there's no way I can reply to him. I have no words to give him. Maybe Osamu could do it. He's an author. Me, on the other hand, lack the education to come up with elaborate expressions. Kuchi Ryo fell silent and took a step back so I could better hear his regretful words. I hate letters. I'll write letters. Lots and lots of letters. Where could we go? A warm place would be nice. Tropical island with palm trees. There are many fun things waiting for us. There's much that the world wants to tell. Both you and me. No. I'll write letters. Lots of them. Screw letters. Ugh. So you won't be lonely even when you go back home. I hate letters. This had the opposite effect. What's he doing at the convenience store? Oh. What the hell are you doing? You just put something in your bag, didn't you? Let me go. Still haven't noticed. Put it back and let's get out of here. Are you always so... Suo? Shut up. Surrounded by darkness and the pouring rain, a single silhouette was running, so he could stop Suo Kato as he vanished into the past. Suo, where are you? Suo! Wanted to wipe away the worry that they would never meet again. Like he repeatedly wiped the water trickling down his jaw. I can't meet him. Is that because it's 2012 now? Is it because I killed him? No, Kikuchi Ryo. It's because I ran away on that winter day, on 2003. It's not your fault. He looked wherever his eyes could see. Please don't disappear, I still... Yet he was the one who wanted to meet where nowhere was found. Still haven't given you a reply. Hello, Flibuster. And that's why you returned to me. In the silence, only the sound of falling water could be heard. Where's Suo? I don't know. The place he looked at was distant, covered in mist and hard to see. Why are you here as your past self? Samajima wasn't even meeting his gaze. Suo's not here. Blood escaped as he bit his lip. He smiled, tasting the iron, and let pain escape through his mouth. What will you do then? The intense rain drowned out all other sounds. Will you meet your end here too? Drenched in black, the man standing there was like a natural phenomenon. Lask again, where's Suo? He wouldn't kiss up to him, nor would he back down. You met his end in 2003, the year you were supposed to die. There's no more room for fantasy. Metallic sound rang out. Samajima had thrown a knife on the asphalt. Take it. Metallic silver was sharply reflecting the city lights. Why not end this? The traffic lights turned blue and gave a dangerous tint to their side profiles. You must have grown tired of extending this. The flickering seemed to speed up their thoughts. Tired of looking for Kato, becoming Mamiya, and holding this bond to me. So let's fight to the death, shall we? You and I? A red color painted the ground from the side. There's no way I can do that. It's the only wish I couldn't realize with Mamiya. He never fought back, you see. I won't commit murder. No cars were passing by, nor stopping when the light was red. I have no intention of playing along with your sick hobbies. The traffic lights remained unchanging. You think I'm alone in this? You're the same as me, Ryo, so I don't stop feigning ignorance. The change in his aura put him on high alert. I can't bear this for much longer. Samajima closed the distance between them. Ah! See, you took the weapon in hand. I, just as Samajima said, Kikuchi was now holding the knife he dropped on the floor. Impressive, you did it subconsciously and so quickly at that. No, this is good, this is right, these are your instincts. Samajima attacked with his elbow and Kikuchi couldn't evade it. Not enough, is it? One more. Are you starting to remember? Did the Mamiya I instill begin to sprout? Was he gonna make a move? Was he? Samajima Satoru. Was he simply dying to fight Kikuchi Ryo like one beast against another? No. I've decided that I'll no longer succumb to these urges and act violently. The heat of the emotions quickly began to cool down. Enough of that, then. A thrust into the stomach. You'll die a painful death for disappointing me. How anticlimactic. Cold. This isn't it, Kikuchi Ryo. This isn't my Mamiya. Samajima's long fingers were pushed against Ryo's stomach. You are all Mamiyas, so you must answer our expectations. Cold made his consciousness go hazy. Ryo wondered if this was the pain Suo had felt that day. He felt a bitter emptiness as if something important was escaping his body. I'm begging you. Please let me witness that strange rainbow again. There was no response. Meanwhile, red blood was spilling out of his stomach. What? You can't die here. Hey, Kikuchi Ryo, this ending is not what I want. No. No, Kikuchi Ryo, you can't die. I didn't want an ending like this. I have to do something. I have to think of something. Couldn't let the story end here. No, I don't want an ending this. That's exactly why I mixed 1999 and 2012. Exactly. You mixed 1999 and 2012. Kikuchi Ryo's premonition is correct if it's 2012. But this moment is both 2012 and 1999. You know what I mean by that, right, Natsumi? I do. Yeah, I do. If it's 1999, Kikuchi Ryo will be able to meet Suo Kato. Right, it's gotta be 1999. We looked at each other as though we were people in the same boat. Within the rain, I gathered the wet paper falling around and brought it to a close. I'll once again bind the what-if scenario from 1999. As I began to run, the Umiya stood still. We were like representations of stillness and motion. It was as though we naturally understood our roles in a ritual that neither of us discussed. Mamiya Yumihisa's voice echoed in the rain. I'm still holding the remnants of a devastated century. That's not it. I lost many things in the sea and acquired a certain bitterness. The words he was reciting were familiar. They were the contents of a letter Suo Kato once wrote. That's not it either. No. I'm still waiting for your return, unable to consign the remnants to darkness. When night comes, Mom gives me something warm and Dad pats me on the back. Perhaps I should have done the same to you. Why do I find you so enviable? This is it. The Suo Kato story that I saw before I decided to intervene. Was a story that stood out even among all those centered on the friends who came to my funeral. They'd actually met in 1999. Please don't forget. But Mia stopped reading and looked up. Please don't forget me. Within the darkness, their eyes met. Did these words truly belong to Suo Kato? There was an emotion in Mamiya Yumihisa's voice as he spoke, but where was it coming from? Mamiya, why are you? Mamiya said nothing and only smiled. Wait! Extended hand touched nothing but the paper, quickly flying by. Wait, Mamiya! Stormy wave of history carried away and drowned out time itself. When he got up, there was silence all around. He couldn't even hear the rain. The sandy beach was oddly warm. He didn't even want to part with the sand touching his cheeks. Where am I, and where's Suo? Kikuchi Ryo. He looked up when he heard his name spoken. There he saw a pair of ruby eyes that looked like they were on the verge of tears. Here? Before he could finish, the man pulled him by his hand and embraced him. That golden curly hair reminded Ryo of dandelions in the sunlight. He knew he could do it. I feel like I've always wanted to be like you. There was no one else but them on the silent beach. Light breeze caressed them, gently treating the fatigue from the cold. Your name is... I'm sorry, I can't remember. Right. This really feels really nostalgic somehow. Though that probably doesn't mean much coming from a guy who was an amnesiac. You've been looking out for us all this time, haven't you? All without even telling us your name. The evening sun was quivering ever so slightly as it sank into the sea. Be it storm or snow, you lamented our pain like it was yours and wished the best for us, didn't you? Thanks. All I did was selfishly make you act the way I wanted. Even if you call it selfish, the generosity you're showing us is beyond compare. Hearing that from you, of all people, makes me feel like I don't need anything else. Don't be modest. You have someone closer to you who can give you even better words. Think so? Of course. The man he could only meet in his dreams put on a faded smile. I was the one who treated you as my inspiration, not the other way around. Just walking with you side by side like this made me feel like everything had been worth it. Did I protect Suo? Well, might not be able to meet again, but I had to encourage him to seek out his own happiness. You should see for yourself. Wish will be heard. Woke up at the beach. Looking around, he didn't see Suo Kato or the man in the trench coat. Oh, phew. Blood left his side as he tried to get up, but he pretended not to notice. I remember everything. This was 2012, where he had a precious sister. He certainly couldn't forget his ties to Suo Kato. What a relief he was able to get back to 2012. I feel like I rewrote fate and got a happy ending, but this just solved one of the problems. There were still many issues he'd left behind in 2012, like the one surrounding Arasugawa Osamu and Kikuchi Ryo. Can I forgive Arasugawa Osamu for what he did? A terrifying thought entered my mind. I'm able to give him a punishment. Ooh, this is new. I'll punish him. I can no longer tolerate Arasugawa Osamu. There's one thing I can take from you. Is this my place? It's 2012. Midori. Ryo. Midori was calmly sitting in the room. There was a man next to her. Osamu. Let out a shout. Gratitude and guilt made Ryo hide his face and reveal his feelings without even looking at Arasugawa. I think of Suo, I can't forgive you, which is why, despite being yelled at from close up, Arasugawa was making a somewhat confused face. Osamu, what's wrong? Huh? Midori, there's something not quite right about him. Ryo, are you there? Man opened his sealed lips, and with trembling hands reached into empty space. Ryo, where are you? Osamu? It's all dark, I can't see a thing. What are you saying? It's noon, I won't play along with this. Alright, I get it, I messed up, so please turn on the lights. Come on. Arasugawa Osamu had gone blind. It'd take long for panic and fear to set in. He's been saying this ever since he woke up. Dory didn't seem to understand what was happening. Ryo tried to keep the panicking beast from scaring her too much. Calm down. We'll just get you to the hospital. Need a phone. Right, the payphone. Grasping at some coins, he prepared to rush out. Hello there. Seems to be some commotion here. What happened? Samajima, don't walk in with your dirty shoes. So scared that's all you can say? Well, you are a child too. I suppose it's only natural. Now who will look after the piggy? First, hospital. I can take him there if you want. But I'm quite certain it's already too late. The man who'd lost his light was shockingly helpless. Overcome by panic and fear, he looked like a child separated from his guardian. But it seemed unlikely that Arasugawa could live an independent life by himself. Kikuchi Ryo was about to say the words that he would be the one to care for him. I'm joking. Samajima Satoru said that and put on an awkward smile. Your child, focus on your studies. I will look after him. It's okay. There's no need for you to worry. Despite how it may seem, this wouldn't be my first time living with him. They were intrinsically self-aware of the violence overflowing in the world. They were black sheep that couldn't fit in due to their awareness and delicate subtleties. When the world ended, leaving only the two of them, no one would torment them with strange looks. No one would scorn them for their savagery. No one would laugh at them for anything. Not a cane. The other was keeping close, maintaining a slow pace, used his long legs. Wind feels nice. It does. Oh, there's ducklings swimming around. Really? I hear the water moving. It's almost spring, after all. Flowers in bloom yet? No, not yet. There's flower buds, though. Are they apricots? Can you tell? No, I don't know flower names, but I will look into them before our next walk. Sorry for the trouble. Spring breeze swept through the air. Gentle sunlight made one and only one of them squint. One of them whose time had stopped at winter. Its bright sun was far too dazzling. They knew they would never go back to their youth when they rushed through the darkness. If I'm to be honest, I've always been envious of your wealth of knowledge. I admire it even now, and always will. Not just being nice, I do mean it. That's so. Arasagawa sounded a light chuckle, knowing full well that Samajima wasn't the type to give empty compliments. Desolate spring light, and the stream continued to shine. Okay, so we got ending 7. No, I need to rethink this. I can't let myself act so arrogantly. First, I should hope that Kikuchi Ryo is safely delivered to the hospital. So, Kikuchi Ryo was brought to the hospital. After an emergency treatment, he briefly fell into a deep sleep. Ryo! And then he was reunited with his sister. Midori, finally I get to see you. It hurts, hey, I'm the one who wanted to hug you. Sorry. Ryo. Samu. Glad you're alive. Thanks. Within the evening courtyard, the dry sheets were gleaming in the light. The two silhouettes peeking out from behind them belonged to Arasagawa Osamu and Kikuchi Ryo. You don't want to go back to my place? What are you saying? I can't pay the hospital fees, but I'll work to earn it back, so just let me live with Midori. The child could barely find the right words and didn't know where to look, and the adult didn't fail to notice that. He grabbed him by the shoulder, standing in his way and making him the only thing the boy saw. But we're family now. I also wanted to be like you, but when I became an adult, I found myself tired. Childish voice rang out from behind. It was similar to Osamu's, yet still distant. You need to think about how to fend for yourself. You'll need some kind of respite to get through things. That's why I want you to be with me. My form of respite, after all. Really think that I'll just say yes to that? When those words coming from both sides were met with that response, the adult was perplexed. Won't? Grip on the shoulder became painful. He trembled as the Jenga tower of his pride began to collapse. No longer just a child who needs your protection. He slapped away the other's arm and ran into the sea of sheets. The shadow of the arm was long, ran beyond the curtains. The wind blew, raising the cloth and causing the sun sinking in the west to make a square shine. Exactly. No one can keep treating you like a child forever. Oh, is this another grown-up version of Suoketo? After all, you're gonna grow old with me. Right, Ryo? Okay, so this is an alternate version of grown-up Suoketo. Okay. Dizziness caused by more than evening sun. For Suo. Breathing raggedly, Arasagawa split the sheets and came between them. Why the hell are you here, Suoketo? You died on that day in 2003, didn't you? Clearly remember seeing you die. The resurrection of this person made him panic so much he couldn't even care about getting Ryo back. Ryo came to save me, all the way to 1999. Because he survived that I'm also alive. Huh? How does that even make sense? Arasagawa gasped as he finally took a good look at Suoketo. It was a 28-year-old adult, a man 1 year older than himself. Yeah, punishment was a cute ending. It really was. But if you wish to talk about what will happen to Ryo, please include me as well. This is a family problem, you got nothing to do with it. What? But the four of us lived together, didn't we? Samu made a bitter face and fell silent. A reasonable assailant would go and receive punishment of his own volition. Right before the sun completely sank and night fell, the three returned to the hospital room. This family problem couldn't be taken care of in just a single day. They agreed to talk the next day, and Arasagawa went outside for a smoke. There's a letter I need to give you. Suoketo took out a black off-standard letter. It's from Samajima. Did you come here to give me a letter from someone who tried to kill me? No, I wasn't planning to give it to you. But I felt it was sad for a letter to not reach its destination. My role is to give it to you and convince you to avoid doing anything dangerous. Ryo, do not accept the invitation in that letter. So Majima must have remembered Ryo writing letters while under house arrest. This was very like him. Ryo opened it and looked over the ugly-looking text. Somajima Sautaro was a terrifying man. He lacked Arasagawa's reasoning skills or social abilities. He could discard everything for the sake of his desires. Once he was done reading, Kikuchi Ryo fell silent before finally looking up. I've always wanted a peaceful life. Life where I don't have to be afraid of someone opening the front door or stay alert while sleeping. That's what you'll have once you're discharged and go back home. You'll have the peace you want. When I lived in 1999 without my memories, having forgotten all the things binding me, I remembered that the real me didn't actually want peace. It's messed up, if I do say so myself. I hate violence. I've always found it scary, how it made me feel like a car without brakes. I do want to live in peace, honest, but my soul is seeking the fire to settle this. That's just how I am. Do you want to die? Of course not, but it looks like I actually like myself when I'm tossed around by absurd violence. Grasped the dark invitation and grinned slightly, making the man sigh. Yes, I knew you wouldn't listen to me if I tried to stop you. Despite what he was saying, the expected response actually made his heart dance. I have no item to gift you that would be able to help you win against him. I'm still bad at fighting, too. But if there's something I can say, he's more open to conversation than you'd think. He's lonely at heart. That man? Seriously? After saying that he'd keep that in mind, Kikuchi Ryo fell silent. Focused his mind on thinking up a counterattack before the promised day came. A few days passed, and his wound had healed so fast it left the doctor positively shocked. Reading the black letter, he rubbed Midori's head. She'd fallen asleep after coming to see him. I wonder what you're dreaming about. He pictured a warm place where he lived with her, something he never wanted broken again, something that had to be broken to proceed. Both were necessary. Won't run. It's also I can go back to the place where my family waits. You will go to that place, my Ryo? At night, when he'd snuck out of the hospital, he was accompanied by the familiar illusion. You always called yourself my dad. Is that because you're a creature born from Osamu? No, at this point, I'm a part of you. You no longer have to seek a father. Mamiya walked beside Ryo like a wraith, but it didn't make him feel like the discomfort he used to. Words weren't needed between them. From here on out, Mamiya would recite a poem about a heroic adventure. With those words behind him, the champion looked ahead and what he'd have to defeat. Like a prideful beast that breaks its shackles and curries favor with no one. Mamiya's young hand pointed the way. You will grasp your true self and be able to use all your power as truly yours. He took a deep breath, letting the night air pierce his lungs. You fear nothing, for you have the gallant blade of gold you earned in 1999. Every second seemed longer than the last as the moment approached. Time has come to awaken from the dream. As he exhaled, Mamiya let go of the balloons in his hand. Run, Kikuchi Ryo. The moment he shouted, Kikuchi Ryo rushed through the night. Behind him, the colorful balloons released into the sky became more and more distant. Guess it's hard for us to keep holding on to air full of dreams. Oh boy. He was found the moment he arrived at his destination. The man with the car behind him had a smile that was clearly visible even in the darkness. I've been waiting for you, Kikuchi Ryo. When he opened the door to the passenger seat, Ryo simply climbed inside. Scenery whizzed past like a life flashing before his eyes. The artificial traffic and streetlights drew an arc as they passed. The damp highway was sliding through the lower area of his vision. There was no background music, the only sound between them was that of a large car slicing through the air. Eventually, a massive bridge came into view. The bridge was a manifestation of human wisdom. Do you like rainbows? As they passed through the middle of the bridge, Samajima Sotaro asked that question. Not really. If anything, they're just weird. Is that so? It does truly seem like your soul bears many similarities to both mine and Mamiya's. Romantic scenery was constantly ringing alarms in the distance. Soft lights weren't giving him a way out. Ignoring the scenery, Samajima Sotaro talked as if reading a poem. Let us talk. Next to a cliff tower that seemed to touch the lead clouds above, I'm certain you will come to like me. judging monologue, gaze down at the bleeding sheep below, spread out the enshrined mine and turn it into soup. Consume it all as though it is of no significance. You're capable of that. Kikuchi-ryo merely stayed silent and listened to words that sounded almost like a confession of love. The dark water below the bridge wasn't taking it at all. Here we are. Let us walk from here. They stopped at a port with a clear view of Tokyo Bay. They walked toward the areas with fewer people, where the dark swallowed the light. With ghost-like steps, they walked ahead. This is pleasant beyond words. Can you understand this joy? His smile was like music that didn't exist in this world. I can't. How sad, said Samajima with an exaggerated tone as he moved his slender limbs. The warehouse that was perfect for them was right there. Is anything the matter? Once he was sucked in by this square maw, there was no going back. No. He had no intention to run. Kikuchi-ryo didn't need to be told anything or get brainwashed for this. He was born under a star that made him despise running away. Let us go. After all, he was originally the one doing the hunting. The moment he stepped into the warehouse, a hook flew to his left cheek. He saw this coming. He moved his center of gravity to push it aside, then put power into his leg further away to kick Satoru's side. Chuckle from above, and the man who didn't even protect himself was sent flying like a rag. I wondered how this would play out if you weren't into this. Looks like I was worried for nothing. Satoru smiled. It seemed like an expression of his gratitude for accepting the challenge. You came here because you couldn't stop your own violent nature. In this harsh world, we should allow violence to take control of us. Let us allow power to completely overwhelm us, shall we? Before we begin, I'm going to tell you one thing. Go ahead, I'll gladly listen to your final words. You're getting something wrong. I didn't come here to die, and your understanding is off. Oh? I stopped denying that I'm violent. That is why you should stop too. I'm saying if you don't want to have your violent self be denied, don't deny my violent self either. Not sure I follow. Samajima, if you want to be forgiven, you need to forgive others as well. So start by forgiving my violence. Whoever asked for forgiveness? You're at odds with society. It's painful, isn't it? They try to correct you. You try to correct yourself. Yet the black sheep that you really are couldn't be subjugated. I get it. I'm saying this because I really get it. Accepting me as I really am, you will be able to forgive yourself. Is that so? Such disappointing words. His raised arm twisted like a whip and went to crack open Kikuchi-ryo's skull. It's the same. The dull sound, the power of the impact was cancelled out. Between the arms, one could see their eyes. Hot sparks rose between them, came fists that touched the tip of Samajima's nose. You couldn't do this with Mamiya, right? Fighting to the death, I mean. You have an immoral, vulgar, and shitty dream that no one in society would approve of. Kikuchi-ryo spat out those words before looking straight at him again. I'm gonna make it come true. The blood flowing from his nose touched the edge of his mouth, cracked open in a joyful grin. Bring it, Satoru. Forget peaceful days and bright futures. Look at me, and only me. Parted wind, bouncing flesh, convulsions. They grappled each other. Their fluids covered them both in layers. Violation, slacking, followed by punches. Their breathing eventually became rhythmical. There was a sense of unity in their damp sighs. A dodge, a constriction, an escape, and an exchange. The metal he grasped slid away due to all the sweat on his hands, yet he clung to it again. Young fist sunk it into the arm of the suit and twisted it in a strange way. Samajima was hit by a sharp metallic pain that couldn't come from human bone. Oh, how nostalgic. Kikuchi-ryo was wielding knuckle dusters, a tool used by Arasakawa Osamu as well. must have used them because he was green, but you... Now that he was overflowing with adrenaline, the pain was but a slight inconvenience. He gave up on the broken arm and tried to kick Kikuchiro's body away with a roundhouse kick. A strike that came from the bone supporting his long legs and his hard muscles. It smashed into Ryo's back, resulting in pain that made him feel like he would burst open. Gah! Before collapsing, he fixed his stance and twisted his body to punch Sadara's solar plexus. Gah! The fist twisting into the pit of his torso. It seemed to mess up his insides. Vibrations coming from the fist devastated the flesh underneath his clothes, and an immense joy came from right where they were touching. Blood was pooling in places around them. In this world reflecting it all, their eyes burned like fire. Their bodies, their instincts, their pain, their pleasure. They wanted every single thing from each other. They wanted to subjugate the other and make them know they were above them as living beings. That was the law of this world, the truth that the intelligent modern man tried to discard. It was our primal instinct. He wanted to know. Satoru wanted to see beyond his limits, to see what would happen once the brain's limiters were shattered. Wanted a taste of the world that could only be reached with this man, who knew the same joy as him. Wanted the sadness of having been born. Wanted the joy he could never have. Wanted to be as hopeless as a hopeless beast and ravage him. More. Sadara, there's more to you than this. You're not being serious, right? Kikuchiro smiled in the way no one had seen before. He was like a rare cryptid beast that had been released from his heavy shackles. Samajima Sadara was overcome by deep emotion. For some reason, he'd become unreasonably happy. So unreasonably happy, it nearly brought him to tears. He wanted to crush him. I like you. He wanted to dominate him. So much. Wanted to subjugate him. This moment, their minds contained nothing but each other. Arasagawa Osamu, Suoketo, Kikuchi Midori, Ramiya, all of these were either in the past or the future. In the present, there was only the flesh of Kikuchi Ryo and Samajima Satoru. Ha! The man responded to the confession by spitting out saliva and blood. That response was more than enough. They were the beasts mankind would be if it abandoned civilization and morals. They wanted to love each other as the pure animals that they were, their scorching violence included. The warehouse around them was in a gruesome state as the two lay collapsed on the floor. Somehow still breathing, they were barely clinging on to life. Oh dear, looks like I'm getting old. You're younger than you should be, dammit. You look younger than you did when we first met. Do I really? I suppose it's because I have a healthy diet. After Kikuchi ignored Samajima's casual words, he felt the touch of fingers on his neck. What? Dog tags. Wasn't that tasteful? Stop. Keep away. Did you know that this is used as identification for those who died on the battlefield? I didn't. I just wore it because it's cool. Honestly, I do not care about it myself. Despite what he said, he was clawing at the air over and over. If you die, then what does it matter? It changes if your name is left behind. Never thought about the bereaved family? After a short silence, he nodded. Till now, I thought it was hopeless. With his bloody back, he peacefully lay down. Does it not infuriate you to see people casually going through life while bearing the very thing you're trying to restrain? It's maddening, really. Why must I be the only one who suffers? It only makes sense they should suffer too. That's why suffering with you brought me some semblance of salvation. Now that you've accepted your violent self, will you stop suffering with me? No, I'll keep on suffering. But I won't use society or common sense as excuses for not being able to restrain myself. Whatever I do, I'll take responsibility for it. That's the real meaning behind not running away. You truly are detestable. The tall man slowly got up. You're saying I should turn myself in. You didn't get punished for killing Mamiya, right? As for the harm you did to me, you'll be judged by society according to the rules. Kikuchi Ryo looked right at Samajima Satoru's face and put on a brotherly smile. I'll visit you in jail. Very well. It was a mystery why the 17-year-old boy knew what Majima Satoru truly wanted. The morning light spilled in through the warehouse door, shining on their wounds. Someone's here. Wait, is that blood? Are you okay? Well, finally, sorry if it's a bother, could you call an ambulance? Nick, you're alive? Okay. Hope we're still breathing by the time it arrives. What do you mean? Keep on living for a long time after this. We'll live on and wake up tomorrow to repeat our unchanging every day. Even more light flooded in through the open door. It seemed to almost burn Samajima's face. And when he turned away to not be blinded, he saw the beautiful rainbow shining white in the morning light. I'm feeling both lucky and happy. Do you know why I'm mad at you? Because the hospital fees were higher than expected? No, it's because of your arm, your waist, and your hip bones are broken. I did ask you if you wanted to die, but I didn't think you would fight until you're barely alive. Oh, well, but the doctor said that I recover abnormally fast. You can't recover from being dead. Sorry I made you worry. I'm just glad you're okay. I'm glad I went. It made the blood leave my head and help me cool off. Jeez, what? Do what you want. Are you mad? No, I just realized how hopeless you are. Recover already so we can get some... go eat some meat or something. You do that with me even though I'm hopeless? Of course I would. I see. I didn't expect the day when I'd see you like this to actually come. I told you I'd visit you in jail, didn't I? Yet you failed to do just that for 9 whole years. Yeah, well, I don't know shit about how time flowed for you. How mean. You truly are Ryo. I had no idea you'd turned yourself in after what happened in 2003. I did, yes. I was jailed for kidnapping, confinement, and murder. The moment I saw Kaito holding you in the snow, I turned and went straight to the police. You didn't kill anyone. Kaito's alive. Is that so? That's wonderful news. I went to see my mother. I see. I hated her and she caused me so much pain, but once we were separated, I no longer knew how I felt about her. Even so, Kaito told me I don't have to force myself to patch things up with her. He was by my side and told me I should keep a distance from her for now. You two sure get along. He said I can forgive her when I feel like it. That's what I wanted you to hear. You may have forgiven my violence. Can you do the same for your mother's? I'm not sure. But I'll settle things before I die. You got the letter I sent you, right? Yes, without any issue. So write a reply. What if I don't want to? You won't be able to say that once you read it. Oh dear. Thought you'd have learned your lesson by now, but you just keep giving me reasons to remain attracted to you. Hey, what's so fun about taking photos of me? You said I could take photos of whatever I wanted. Guess I did. Is this good? You're too stiff. Is this soft enough? That's not what I meant. I don't get it. Whatever, let's take a walk. They walk through the city side by side, making sure to take their time. They pass the place where he had a night shift as a security worker. The pavement had actually been fixed since then. They pass the pedestrian bridge he once tripped on. His nosebleed at the time was quite startling. They pass the back alley where he was approached by a bunch of guys who pinned him to the floor. He went on to beat them to a pulp some other day. But this wasn't exactly a good town. Might have been mediocre at best. Still, this was the place where he had lived his entire life until now. For him, there was no other town like this. Hey Kaito, what's in that paper bag? You noticed? Ta-da! I brought you some donuts! Pick whichever one you'd like. Yay! Don't pamper her too much. You'll obviously go for the strawberry ones, right? Well, yeah. In the end, the Kikuchi siblings didn't live with Suo Kato. They chose to return to the years-old apartment they'd lived in for many years, and continue with the same routine they used to have before. I mean, I can't just have you supporting us all this time. Oh, don't worry about that. It's not just my money. Oh, what's that in the oven? Are you cooking what I think you are? It's gratin. You like it, don't you? Yay! And the donuts will be a post-dessert meal. Man, you're loud as always. I went and had Midori's photos developed. Oh, that sure is a lot of them. Oh. Bicycle at the shopping street of Camilla blooming next to the apartment. Plain stone on a gravel path. Among these, there was a photo that stood out. That's a good one, isn't it? Captures the essence of Kikuchi Ryo. It was a photo of Kikuchi Ryo standing in town. It was a fragment of a mundane scene that seemed to carry a silent sense of presence. You gotta capture the subject in their natural state. That's one of the basics of being a cameraman. Hear that? Ryo looked at the photo intently. I see. I'm fine the way I am, huh? Until now, Ryo had only known that scenery from his point of view, but looking at it from this different perspective, I never really understood why people describe me as the main character, a cheetah, or the first star. Now that I look at this picture, I think I get it. I see. The photo showed a young man in his teens, who was so full of the light of life that he didn't seem to fit modern society. Despite that, his presence wasn't in conflict with it. He and society coexisted. It's a very good photo. It really is. You're an amazing guy. It's not me who's amazing. It's Midori. Midori! Yeah? It really is a good one, though. Hey, can I try putting it up in the competition? Sure. I want to go to a flower garden next. Suo Kato went on to enter Kikuchi Midori's photo in a competition. Won first place in Young Portfolio. But that was a story for another time. Kikuchi Ryo actually came to class first thing in the morning. This is the first time I've seen him with a backpack. Morning, Minato. It was quite a sight. Kikuchi Ryo, hold on. Didn't feel any aversion to simply talking in class. Morning, Ryo. I figured I should start by studying. I finally got the time for it. So having to get dozens of stitches made you cool off, huh? Shut up. Dozens of stitches? Toja's pretty scary, too. Kikuchi wants to study, huh? Hope it works out for him. Your dad's a police officer, right? Yes, he is. Same. Wait, why are you backing away a little? I just asked because I was curious. Curious about what? Well, I was just wondering how you become a policeman. Don't get me wrong, it's not that I want to be one. I see. Here. Wow, a career choice survey. I got it from my homeroom teacher and ignored it for the longest time. Take it. Ryo spoke as if wringing his words out. I always avoided studying because I assumed it was only for those who had the time for it. Now I want to learn so I can think of what a guy like me could do. I want to try thinking about the near future a bit. I still don't know what I want to do for a living, but if you can, I want you to help me. Of course. Starting a letter was always a tense thing for him. Why not write a letter to my dad? He's a nice person, so I'm sure he'll answer. He took the advice and picked up a pen, but the first line was enough to almost break him. Dear Kato's father. Your sir? Should I use his name? What's the right way to do it? The evening star was shining at the edge of the sky. The early morning sky before dawn... daybreak was clear and seemed to reach all the way beyond. Aren't you cold? Nope. I took lots of hand warmers. Thanks to Midori's newfound taste for photography, they went to unknown places far more often. They gently sought out sceneries they'd never seen before, along with the new scents. I wonder what kind of photos you'll take. I'm so excited. There were still many things that they didn't know. There are possibilities hidden. They rushed through the long night. Ryo wondered what the Earth may have been like long before he was born. The positions of the stars used to be different. The ecosystem had also gone through countless changes. This was but a small part of an ever-continuing routine. They were running at the forefront of an unfathomably ancient relay. Ah, beyond the horizon, a star burning large gradually showed itself. Eyes the color of Venus saw a camera. Rio, look over here! And thus, the forefront of billions of years were captured. Let me check to see where the stream is real quick before we make this decision. Yeah, thanks. I've been going for about an hour and a half now. Actually thinking I should probably take a break. Since Kikuchi Ryo and Suo Kato's stories were so connected, since their stories were so connected, Toji Minato and Morichika Haruki. Would be next, and I think their stories might be connected. So, I'm gonna go with Toji Minato, but we're gonna take a quick break and we'll be right back. All right. Ow! Friends and enemies. Hello. Hello. For those of you just tuning in, hi, we are the Dronus Lair System. My name is Kyrieve. And my name is Adrian Agrest. Hello. We are a DID system. The two of us are co-conscious at the moment, meaning we're accessing memories at the same rate of speed and with the same accuracy as each other. We're also both actively in the body at the moment. Adrian started out playing this because I had previewed all the way through to the start of Downfall. So I all of Fall Down and... Wait, hold on. Do I have that backwards? Hold on. Let me check. Yep. We did all of Fall Down to preview to see if Adrian would be able to handle the themes and topics that this visual novel would contain, and so far so good. Unfortunately, for us, we now have Natsumi and Mamiya living in our head. Not the Mamiya of the four victims, necessarily, but Suoketo's Mamiya, who is Mamiya Yumehisa, and Natsumi, who is the spectator. We've got versions of them living in our head now, as they were at the end of, making sure I say this right, Downfall. So they're learning more about their original source material's intention. Okay. But yeah, as you can see, Natsumi's currently covered in blood. But yes, we have completed both Kikuchi Ryo and Suoketo's stories. Looks like this is the side Daydreams. I think the next side is Doomsday. And we have decided to start with Tojo Minato. So without further ado, let's get into it. Right. My, or rather Natsumi Sorichiro's death. What was the meaning behind the mobile phone Natsumi gave to Tojo Minato before his death? As the man stood with his back against the church wall, lost in thought, a silhouette passed by him. Yuka? Felt like hearing your voice, so... Hey! Hello, She's changed her number. Man. He was calling whatever numbers he had. It seemed like he had no place to stay. Are you calling someone? Sorry, old man. Was I too loud? Being called old man made me gasp a little. Was the thing Nodomi taught me actually working? Still regret never calling. Huh? There's a person I exchanged numbers with, but never actually called. Still can't bring myself to delete the name in the contact list. Listen to your memory some other time. Huh? Weird. He was just here. What a strange day. It's not like he'll pick up. Watering that, he made a call to Natsumi in his contact list. One beep, two beeps, three beeps. It connected. Hello? A voice that didn't belong to Natsumi came from the receiver. Hello? Huh? From below the withered tree in front of him. Dressed as they were at the funeral, the two went to the cafe. Tojo Minato was holding the phone so tightly his hands were turning white. Why the hell do you have Natsumi's phone? Did you kill him? Of course not. Then why is it with you? Who gives their phone to other people? You just gave it to me out of nowhere. It's crazy that you'd suspect me for that. Crazy? Of course I'd suspect you. I mean, Natsumi's death is shrouded in mystery. It was said that Natsumi's corpse was found 3 days after he died. It just makes no sense. I don't really care. I don't even want to know what killed him. I'm honestly not interested in it at all. Sorry. Right now, I'm just too devastated that it even happened. His cold fingers grasped the phone. It seemed as though he was thinking about why he and Mina was left with so much guilt. Wallowing in how it makes you feel won't get us anywhere. Huh? I want to unravel the mystery of his death. As he said that, Marichika Haruki reached toward the phone. Give it to me. No! You don't even know why he gave it to you, right? Then let me have it. This is something that Natsumi gave me. He raised his voice. His raised voice made the cafe fall silent for a moment. So what, are you gonna just cling to it forever? I don't know, but I'm the one who took it, so I'll do whatever I want with it. I'm telling you, that's a waste of good evidence. Their exchange escalated as the two tried to force their opinions on the other. I remembered what Nodome had told me. A MacGuffin? Yes, have you heard of them? Even if something may be important to the characters, to us spectators, it could be nothing but a little push that moves the plot. It doesn't matter if the phantom thief steals a diamond or a sapphire. What matters is that the characters take action. A push that can make characters act. In that case, I myself will become a MacGuffin. Excuse me, could you please not be so loud? I'm sorry. Let's cool down for a bit. That was just a little push to set the story on the right course. Nothing more, nothing less. And it's not like I have a name anymore. Why do you even want to look into Natsumi's death? It won't change the fact he died, right? It's exactly because that fact is unchangeable. I can't move on if I don't find out and understand the reason why he died. How else could you process his death? Alright, I won't give you the phone, but it will help with your investigation. I understand how you feel, I'm just too overwhelmed for it right now. An investigation? That makes it sound like it's a job for a private detective. Well, I guess it kinda is. The way Marichika Haruki's words reflected my own made my heart ache. It was close, but they made it on the right course. I'll make the story complete in a way that makes it work even if I'm not there. I shouldn't have brought Natsumi's phone to the funeral. Then again, it's my own fault for not having the courage to give it to his family before the funeral was over. Natsumi was such a nice person. Funeral was over, but I still couldn't process the fact he was dead. Natsumi, why did you give it to me? To Mina? Minato, there's a place I want to stop by. Is this it? I looked up at Mamiya as he stood on the railing and let out a sigh. This river, huh? Minato, over here. Wait, Mamiya. Ah! Oh, my shoe slipped off. Oh, man. The fine gravel was digging into my palm, making it sting a little. You dropped this. Suddenly, a shoe was extended to him. Sorry, and, thank you. For a moment, I felt embarrassed and thankful for the kindness of this random person. When I looked up, all the words I had were blown away. You're doing as well as ever. Toma. Sorry for startling you. Yeah, it's me. Long time no see, Minato. And it finally moves. In a world where 1999 and 2012 meet, shared illusion will become even stronger. That doesn't mean anything before my ego. I will save them from Mamiya, no matter what. The sound of rolling film. Persistent noise of the projector. Music continued to flow, like a river never ending. You'll listen to my sins? Happiness was something that slipped right through the fingers. but it felt like my breathing was becoming thinner with every second in the past. I can say that I never wanted this, but I'm sure you don't want to hear something so irresponsible. What would you do if the world came to an end tomorrow? It was a silly conversation starter, nothing more than pointless small talk. Anything I could say now would be said too late, all because I chose this path that day. I doubted anyone else was looking forward to the end of this world as much as I did. My life had always felt like I'd been watching it in third person, like a movie. We'd been repeating this for so long. If it were to end, I would want it to be a spectacle. Make an ensemble cast work even, something large scale that would downplay my personal pain. It could only be achieved with madness, and I signed the contract with my own hand. Something small and frail that we gave our all to protect. A soul that lost even that, just be left here, unable to go anywhere. That way, I wouldn't have to bear the shivering on my own. There's no running from it anymore, is there? This can end it all. I will discard my will and obey your every command. This cold clockwork town, nobody paid any mind to me. May it all go according to your will. Arma mia. And the river continued to flow. Song is a kind of guy to look at me new and push it up. Get the sky, you were out of your sink and you got to push it up. Song is a kind of tomatoes to me, you are a push it up. Get the sky, I'm tomatoes, but the wind's a push it up. I don't know all the words, but it's so catchy. Every time. Not friends. Are we really gonna look at it? I really don't feel like it. Just do it. Don't boss me around. If someone gets mad at us, it's gonna be your fault. Maid? There's lots of vids of the same woman. Who is she anyway? No idea. An internet famous model, maybe? She really doesn't have the looks to be an idol. Huh? Don't act like you know Mina. Oh, so you do know her. Maybe? She's internet famous, right? If I search for her, there, the Cinderella Maid. I guess we should go talk to her. I doubt you'll get to meet her. We'll meet her if we go to the Maid Cafe. The website even displays her shifts. Let's not, okay? There's no way she knows anything about Natsumi. She's got a shit tomorrow. You coming? Huh? Well, I'm gonna be kind of busy at that time. And I don't much care for maid cafes and stuff like that, so I'd like to firmly and respectfully decline. That's so. Well, Akiba isn't my kind of place either. I would have guessed as much. Joji Minato was overcome by relief. They had many customers on days off, and it was too late to ask for a shift change. I'm glad he changed his mind. Mina, a customer wants you. Coming. Whoa.
Welcome back, Master.
Didn't you say you weren't coming? I feel like I've seen you somewhere.
You...
And heard your voice, too.
Oh, you too. You must have watched too many videos and got confused. If you bother Mina, we'll have to ask you to leave.
That's so.
Oh, thank you. You really helped me out back there.
That was new. You usually act so tough. That customer was pretty scary looking. Did you know him?
No, me. Acquainted with a guy like that?
Your personal life is still a mystery, huh? Watch out for stalkers.
What's with that guy?
He took off the wig without care for the damage it could do and threw the Mina set into a large bag. I mean, he wants to know about Natsumi, right? Mina and I have nothing to do with it. Hold on. Oops. What do I do, Mamiya? Looks like he still hasn't realized it, but it's a matter of time until he does. You can forget about that man. The thing is, I can't. He knew Natsumi.
Natsumi?
Following a sigh, he realized that this panic he was experiencing was familiar. Oh, it just hit me. He's the first one since Mamiya who knows both me and Mina. Natsumi first came to the maid cafe during the winter of last year.
Manager, what's with that video?
Monitor showed a video that was a real cause for concern. This promo wasn't made by us, but it's all good. You got lots of fans because of it. Every refresh increased the viewer count, so the manager celebrated by clapping. I have the rights to my likeness. I request a takedown immediately. Hey, your shift's about to begin. Mina's resume was put up on the desk. Oh, I'm so glad I hired you. Seeing the part that said Tojo Mina, age 20, female, give Tojo a headache. Do your best out there, Mina.
We'll talk about this later.
The Cinderella maid. Before he knew it, she had received that title. Someone had uploaded Mina's performance without permission, greatly raising her popularity.
I don't really want to stand out too much.
Mina was hiding a secret from the customers, fellow maids, and the one she worked for.
Why doesn't anyone realize I'm a guy?
The previous week, the cafe actually received an email from an entertainment production company, which Tojo could hardly believe. There were many days she considered quitting this job.
But this cafe has the cutest uniform ever!
However, due to that silly reason, Tojo couldn't actually go through with it.
Well, I guess it should be fine, as long as they don't find out. You know, your break's over, hurry up!
Okay. Sticking to that naive idea, Tojo continued to delay the conclusion when...
It's a pleasure to meet you, Mina? Really happy to see you today. A pleasure to meet you, Master.
They hadn't communicated much, but his strange presence made Tojo instantly recognize him. He was Natsumi, a classmate.
What brought you here?
I saw the video, then I fought the reservation war, and I finally made it here. I'm so tense. Right, I gotta order. A rice omelet, please.
Just that?
Oh, the drink. One iced tea, please.
Very well. Please wait a while until your meal is prepared.
That's not what I meant. Mina wanted to ask if he was actually here without knowing that she was a he. Natsumi likes Mina, huh? Taking off the maid uniform, Tojo looked back at the past, along with the facts that he'll never see Natsumi again.
Oh, this takes me back. There's nothing like the street leading to the maid cafe.
Clueless to what Tojo Minato was going through, I excitedly looked around. The area had greatly changed since I first went to the maid cafe. Specifically, there was now way more Mina here. Some people were wearing Mina's clothes, cosplaying her, basically. Others had Mina merchandise that they were taking photos of or using as keychains. She became the face of the town, huh? Took in the scenery. So many people had noticed her charm and were infatuated with her.
Huh? Is that Mina's original song?
I heard a familiar song coming through the street speakers, and my body reacted almost instantly.
Wait, let me join the singing!
happily joined in with all the Mina fans.
Phew. I'm talking to you! Huh? Could you not smoke at school?
Morichika Haruki ignored him and exhaled the smoke. I met a maid recently.
A maid?
You know, the maid you could see in Natsumi's video folder, remember her?
Maybe I do. Not interested in that myself.
You too, huh?
I was wondering, what could have Natsumi that obsessed? But she was nothing special.
Hello? Damn, you're loud. You think you're in a position to say that? You're not any better.
Ouch, damn it. What, you one of our fans too?
And don't act like you were enchanted by her.
Huh, what the hell are you talking?
Wait, how would you know that?
Huh,
Were you following me?
Man, you could have said it. We could have had a meal or something.
Hey, wait up. Don't walk so fast.
Why are you such a fast walker anyway? Don't make me run, dammit.
Score one for the LGBT community having the fastest walking speed in the entire world. Every member, as you know, gets the Power Walking Badge of Honor that goes right alongside having the gay membership card, which cannot ever be revoked. Sorry, I just had to make that joke. God. But yes, every member of the Rainbow Mafia has to have the Power Walking Badge. We are so scared for our lives. And Minato obviously is no exception. Nobody's forcing you to keep up with me. As the man was catching his breath, Toji Minato's frustration took over and made him say that.
Was I being a bother?
A bother? Well, Mina is my, she's my cousin.
Cousin?
Yeah, that's why I don't like him when people say bad things about her. His eyes made it obvious that was a lie he just cooked up, but Morichika Haruki actually stopped and thought for a moment.
I didn't mean to talk shit about your family.
Why does it matter that she's family? You shouldn't talk shit about anyone.
Well, it's not like I'd be hurt if a complete stranger said something bad about me.
They can say whatever they want, so I can say whatever I want too, right?
I don't agree with that.
Nojima Nato ran a finger along the black phone. Was he thinking about someone who was no longer here?
I wonder if Natsumi had siblings.
He was an only child, that's how I remember it anyway. You seem knowledgeable. Were you close to him?
I just knew him for a good while.
He was always by himself. He came with his parents and then just stayed quiet. He put out the now shorted cigarette on the ashtray, almost as if to try and stub out his perplexion. I had my brother with me, so I didn't talk to Natsumi.
Oh, you have a brother. Having close family must be great.
You have Mina, don't you?
Oh, yeah, right. But siblings are a different thing, no? The bonds are stronger.
Bonds, huh? It ain't nothing that fancy. He let out a long sigh as his eyes, the color of wisteria and rain, looked down.
That's nothing fancy at all.
What do you do for a living, Toma?
Toji Minato and Morichika Toma were at a cafe. That day, after meeting up at the river, there was a bit of trouble and they decided to find a place better suited for talking.
The gentleman speaking with a smile on his face was the center of attention and the subject of envy.
A wizard.
Hey, do you still think I'm a child?
But you are.
If you're interested, look up my name on the internet, though you'll probably get more results if you type it out in Romanji.
Whoa, what's with this photo? A mag? An interview?
The industry is smaller than you'd expect, so even young people like me are invited to interviews. It says, when Toma moves his baton, my bow moves on its own. They actually call you a wizard. So that's so cool.
Man, so I guess I set myself up for that one.
The way he was featured in the articles and photos combined with his looks made it clear that he was quite popular.
finally take a break from my job and was able to come back to Japan for the first time in a while. Morichika Toma certainly had a highly refined aura about him. Is that why you suddenly vanished and you didn't tell me? I do really feel bad about it. I'm sorry. It's fine. It's not like much will change if I complain to you about it now. Really? Then let's keep getting along, Minato. That nonchalant attitude took him aback. Well, as long as you don't just disappear again. Wait, oh no, it's almost time for my part-time job. I can get you a taxi. Where do you work? Pure glimmer in his eyes was almost heart-inducing. Oh, I'd be kind of embarrassed if you saw me working. I'll see you off to the station, is that okay? Sure, thanks. If you don't mind, I'd like to hang out with you like we used to. Would you be okay with that? Hey, Toma, you know what you did to me, right? Of course it's okay. You're in a good mood today, Mina. You're grinning from ear to ear. Huh? Really? Tapping your charming face, Mina tried to stay calm. Okay, I'll just get through this shift. Wait, Natsumi's phone is ringing. Mina kept the phone hidden inside the main uniform as a charm. Now its vibrations made her tense. Morichika, sorry, but I'm at my part-time job. Hello? Natsumi? Dumbass, you can't joke like that. It's still a joke, though. Don't get mad. You're being weird. What happened? Hey, Tojo, can you be in Shibuya in an hour? Again, I'm still on my shift. If you don't come, I might die from loneliness. Those were the last words he said before ending the call. Hey! Die? That's another joke, right? But maybe I had a chance to stop Natsumi's death, too. Ah, damn it! So when is your friend coming? Shouldn't be long now. Wait! So Reika was actually a plant by Morichika Haruki? Oh, fuck. That's... God. Okay. Okay, that puts so much more context on what she did to Tojo. Oh, God. It almost makes me sick. Oh, boy. Yeah, I kind of had a feeling this was going to happen. Oh. Jaren. Hi. Sorry about borrowing your voice so much. It's nothing. Don't worry about it. But yeah, I kind of saw this coming. You did and you didn't say anything? You really keep secrets. Yeah, I mean, Wrath and I both use this voice a lot. I know it's not Wrath's natural voice, but... I've been noticing... you using it more often, so I just wanted to pop in and check. We're good. I'm here too. Wrath? Yeah. Kinda the same reason. Oh fuck. Give me a second, I've gotta update my Simply Plural. Oh, I didn't even update it before the stream. That's gonna leave a mark on my record. Ugh, my psychiatrist is gonna kill me. Okay, so currently we have on deck, we have me, and me, and the two of us that sound like we're from Brooklyn. I mean, I could, if you want, I can use a different voice that doesn't quite, you know, Jaren. It's okay. We both feel more comfortable using the Brooklyn voice. Fine. Okay. So, since there's so many of me up here... I'm gonna take a sip of my drink real quick. Give us a chance to settle in. If you guys are interested in watching... Yeah, we're gonna watch. Okay. Just warning you, this game has a lot of trauma in it.
Yeah, we're good. Shouldn't be long now. I want to teach someone how to relax, I guess. Hard to tell if this wait will pay off, though.
No one's coming, then I'll be going.
Wait, the nail in your ring finger. So, what was that about dying? Why is a maid here? Where's Tojo?
I came here in his place. I'm his cousin, after all.
The club was in a stir, but the maid remained resolute. That maid's so cute, I can feel the dedication. Wait, I actually think I saw her on the internet. You're telling me this is your friend?
The drink fell out of her hand and spilled on the floor.
She's just my type! Oh god! Oh god! This makes it worse. Ugh, I actually rushed here, but you're doing just fine.
Why'd you come here looking like that?
A friend said he's gonna die, so of course I'd rush over. Do you even remember what happened recently? You should watch what you say.
A friend.
Saw your face, so I'll go now. I'll never come to a place like this again. Hold it, Tojo!
I said I'm his cousin. I didn't say we shared the same last name.
But you're Tojo, right?
No, I said I'm...
Dance a little. I want to see it.
Are you threatening me?
What was that? Didn't hear you over the music.
Okay, fine, I'll dance.
Mina ran off into an open space on the floor and began dancing to the music. These were dance moves she was supposed to do at the cafe.
Whatever, I'll just do it.
Hey, not bad.
What's with that innocent smile?
Come over here.
Hey, don't push me.
You're not threatening me?
What's your name, maid? Oh, so it's Mina.
How about you? Are you sure you can be out this late?
I'm Reika. Come dance with me.
So into you. When are you coming here again?
I don't think I am.
Huh? Oh no. But I'm always waiting for you at the cafe, m'lady.
Oh, man, someone's good at business.
Buzz off. I'm talking to Mina.
Hey, what's with that difference in attitude?
Come here for a sec.
Mr. Morichika.
What?
Why?
Why did you call me Tojo?
I saw you a bunch of times, I can tell by now.
Do these clothes make you laugh?
Should I give you Natsumi's phone?
Huh? Where did that come from?
I mean, these clothes, I...
Would you be happier if I just treat you as cousins?
Will you?
It's not that uncommon. Doesn't bother me one bit. Also, drink up. It's not an alcoholic.
Gulp, gulp. What are you doing?
Your shift's over, right? That's all good.
Dance until the date changes, Cinderella maid.
A maid who would most certainly stand out in this feverish Shibuya clubhouse. And there was no one for a maid to serve.
Not here.
Sweating in the heat. Her elaborately decorated outfit was sticking to her skin. Even so, Mina continued to dance. Every time she turned, her long hair and skirt would sway. And her white frills and apron framed her like the petals of a flower. Anyone could easily see why the video that was uploaded to the internet without permission had achieved legendary status. How about this step, then?
I can do it.
Oh, well, not bad. Felt good to enjoy the same music and move her body in this manner.
Mr. Morichika.
Suddenly, Mina took Morichika Haruki's hand. Though slender, it was a man's hand nonetheless.
The lights are prettier over here.
When he came to his senses, his hand had been released, and Mina was dancing in the middle of the circle of people.
Ah, the music changed. There's more space here.
Oh, sorry. Mina, I almost lost you.
Shh. I'm the one who should apologize, little maid.
Oh, okay.
She sure was pretty. Do you know her, Reika? No. Let's go over there. Okay. Was she someone you shouldn't bump into? I don't know. Mina, I'm so glad I got to meet you. I'll make sure to visit the cafe. I'll be waiting for you, m'lady. Phew. My uniform's gotten pretty sweaty now, so I'll go get changed. Mina disappeared into the bathroom. Came back as Tojo Minato. What? Nothing. The shadows were cast on the path from the clubhouse to the Shibuya station. Caressing the large bag, Tojo Minato slowly began to talk. Hey. His tone was that of someone who'd gathered his resolve, which put Haruki on edge. Maybe we should actually give it back to Natsumi's family. You mean the phone he left behind? Now that I've appeared before you as Mina, I realize that no matter how much you think by yourself, you won't know the right answer if you don't take action. That's so. That's why I'm thinking of giving it back to his family. Might bring some hate my way, but that's fine by me. He put Natsumi's phone into the side pocket of the backpack. Also, Natsumi's parents may be worried sick. That hurts more than anything else. I see. After parting ways with Morichika Haruki at the ticket gate, he followed the way home as the sky gradually turned brighter. Someone found out, and it's Morichika of all people. He found out, but he was neither disgusted nor pleased. He's unlike anyone in class, and he's always such a mystery. He was overcome by a strange elation. It was an anticipation of coming freedom. It's not as scary as I thought, Mamiya. If I reveal a secret, and I'm accepted despite that, I can feel like I'm actually okay. Tojo Minato was in high spirits, but the gas mask Mamiya was breathing in a way that made him seem unamused. As long as you find it agreeable. Are you jealous I went out clubbing? Aren't you cute? I am not. Is this Mamiya Morichika Toma? Now that I know the truth, the precision of the observation seems to have improved. The story presents possible pages that weren't there before. Hey, Reika, who was that? Mina, my maid. Mina, huh? She spoke the name and smiled within the smoke. Strange feeling. Oh, no. Oh, chills. Okay. So, let me see if I can guess who all's here. There's Toma. There's Nigaki. Who's that other guy? And Tojo Minato. Okay. Okay. The light of the chandelier illuminated the food laid out on the table. Graceful music was playing at a volume too low to bother anyone, creating a refined atmosphere. Everyone seated, I see. I ordered a full course tonight. Just feeling nauseated. We have plenty of time before we'll be finished with our meal. The knife was slipping out of his sweaty hands. Why was he having dinner as part of this group? Why was this game starting? He never intended to participate. Let's enjoy the night, with the four of us. Who is his ally in this game? What did you want from me, miss? Tojo, I want you to help out when the respective students come visit the school this Saturday. Huh? Why me? All students in the Go Home Club are involved. You're no exception. But I have a shift at my part-time job. Students need to focus on their school life. Part-time jobs are tertiary. That's in the school rules. Are we clear? Yes. Here are the pamphlets. Feel free to ask if you don't understand something. Tojo, you're very good at this. You're a great help. I work in customer service. If you really do appreciate me, why not raise my grades in classics? Studies and extracurricular activities are separate things. Man, I had no idea middle schoolers could look so innocent. The girl feels familiar. Looked into his memories, the outfit was different, but he felt like he'd seen her. Reika? Crap. Hey, wait! Come on, you shouldn't run in the hallway. Wait, I'm not getting this. Huh? I really messed up. He must have relaxed too much and let his guard down after Marachika Haruki came to know his secret. Anyway, let's talk in an empty classroom. So first things off, why are you here? You need to be 16 to enter that nightclub. I'm in the third year of middle school. So you're not even in high school. You're a man, you tricked me. You liar, give me back my Mina. Sorry, here, want some candy? Don't treat me like a child. Despite saying that, she took the candy anyway. Did you want it or not? Rolling it around her mouth seemed to calm her down. So you're taking exams this year, huh? It's not hard to make it here, but you don't exactly have time to play around either. I'm not applying to this school anyway, so it's got nothing to do with you, Minato. Huh, why? We came along because my friends are all applying here. Parents decided a long time ago that I'd only go to private schools. The dull sound of the sweets hitting her teeth could be heard. If I had enrolled here next year, we could have been in the same school. Shane. Sulky's side profile was far more charming than the way she acted at the club. A dinner? Yeah, I'm really excited. What should I wear? Do I have anything formal? The sound of the dryer mixed in with a cheery hum. Mamiya was joyfully swinging the baton in time with the song. I'm a little overwhelmed, though. If only the place were a bit more casual. It's an opportunity hard to pass up on. Do not hesitate and go. You're saying it like you're the one who invited me. It's not paid for by you, is it? But yeah, I was invited. It would be unmanly to refuse. Mamiya stopped moving the baton and fell silent for a moment, before looking into Toji Minato's eyes. You may refuse the dinner. Huh? But you're the one who told me to go. You may refuse it if you wish to. Sorry, but I've already decided what I'll wear. I can't wait. It's going to be a fun dinner. This place gives you a really good view of Tokyo Tower. Come, Minato. Okay. Toji Minato's body was so uncomfortably tense. Perhaps I should have picked somewhere more casual. No, I'm happy you picked this place. I'm really excited. Sir, please wait. When Minato tried to sit down, someone reverently pulled the seat out for him, which made him freeze up. He slowly sat down, his face turning beet red as he hung his head. Oh my, what a customer to meet here. Minato was too embarrassed to even look up. Thus, he didn't realize how Morichika Toma's voice... Okay. I'd assume the dark tone. Sure are good at saying nothing. Aren't you Toma? I haven't seen you since we met at Tokyo Tower. So they had a recent meeting at Tokyo Tower. That's a note. Somebody, whoever's taking notes, make a note. They met at Tokyo Tower in 2012. Tojo? Not Tojo. Toma and Nagaki, at the very least, met at Tokyo Tower in 2012. Okay. Oh, this is gonna get twisty. Huh. What was the strange feeling? An intense wave of deja vu and pain, as if the lid on his brain was being pried open. I'm glad you remembered how precious the time is, Nagaki. Nagaki. He might have heard it somewhere, or he might have not. He could remember it, but it might be better not to know. Still, Minato couldn't overcome his curiosity and looked up, only to regret it immensely. It's rare to have nights as interesting as this. Ah. We should enjoy them as long as we can, don't you agree? An indescribable sense of nausea was writhing, swarming within him. Sorry, Tom, I'm not feeling too well. I think we'll go... Hey, I wasn't told about this. Why is he here? A familiar voice made Minato turn around in a flash. Morichika? What are you doing here, Tojo? Oh, Morichika looks so good in a suit! Haruki looks so amazing in a suit! I still don't feel good about this, though! Two looked at each other, but a ridiculing voice split them apart. I invited them. Why? I've known Nagaki since we were students. I figured we should have dinner once I returned. Oh. So it was a group dinner. Well, I guess that makes sense. I'm leaving. Oh, but look how nicely it's all set up. Shut up, there's no way I can eat in this group. Don't be like that, Haruki. Toma's words made the air freeze. Huh? What, you two know each other? No, they're brothers. Huh? How long has it been since we had dinner together? We're family, so how about you treat me better? Or is it exactly because we're family that you mistreat me? The fucking audacity! The chilling eyes directed at Haruki were downright disparaging. We're also very close, aren't we, Minato? Please don't touch me. Tojo, leave with me. Mayuri let go of his hand. Go ahead, Minato, shake my hand off. Mayuri, don't bully him like that. But I want to have dinner with the four of us. Oh, I wouldn't mind if you left. You're leaving? Tojo Minato's lips were slightly quivering. Haruki does look amazing. Yes! He could easily shake off Nagaki Mayuri's slender hand. He had gone pale and was completely frozen in place, as if someone had cast a spell on him. Fine, I'll eat. Haruki aggressively walked to the table and sat down without the waiter's help. Sir! Sorry about the commotion. It's all fine now. Please bring us the food. Nagaki Mayuri looked over everyone at the table and cracked a refined smile. Everyone's seated, I see. I ordered a full course for tonight. We have plenty of time before we eat everything. Let's enjoy the night with the four of us. This CG again. Oh boy. Knowing that's Haruki sitting across the table from Tojo is... Oh, God. Both the conductor Mamiya and the nurse Mamiya are sitting at a table with their targets to turn into Mamiya. This is so twisted. Oh, God. That's why they chose this music. It's classical, but it's also sinister. Oh, gods. And given that we're doing Marichiko Haruki's route after this, I mean, not today. Like, I think I only have time to finish Tojo's route at most. But holy shit. We're gonna have to repeat this dinner again? The nerves. At least we can skip through the dialogue next time. But this time is gonna be pain. Rawr. Yeah. Even while eating the hors d'oeuvres that soon came, Tojo Minato and Morichika Haruki did not say a thing. And as if they weren't even there, the adults were having a chat over some wine. Oh, you'll be going abroad too? Glad we didn't miss each other. A designer who's been good to me asked me to join. Morichika Haruki was lost in thought while eating his matsutake consomme soup. Wondered how he could get out of this. How he could escape the situation without causing trouble for Tojo Minato. Have you perhaps been outside the country on a school trip, perhaps? No, my school trip was to Kyoto. It's great, too. We should go together there sometime. So you're acquainted with our Haruki, aren't you? Our? You're about the same age, so I imagined you might have gotten along. Hey, I'm not as much of an adult as him. Tojo Minato was also in a vortex of bewilderment, completely unable to enjoy the meal. With a pit in his stomach, he was desperately thinking of ways to end this peacefully. So how did you two come to know each other? It's hardly a story worth telling. Why, is it something embarrassing? Come on, my Yuri, stop messing with... Oh, is it a secret? But that makes me jealous. What? Whisper to me in secret. It's been a while, so there's lots of things I don't know. Drop the act. You don't care to know anything about me. Oh, that's not true at all. I'm afraid you're misjudging me. Indeed, we all want to know more about you. She shook her earrings and smiled while eating a langoustine poêle. That nature looked as enchanting as a portrait glimmering in the light. Not convinced.
What an awkward dinner! This dinner is such a mess! I know! And Natsumi is literally like, what an awkward dinner!
Morichika Haruki looks like he just wants to stand up and leave! Oh, there's a new one coming out. Abroad, I see, abroad, And Tojo Minato is desperately looking for something that would make this less awkward.
Oh, why?
Meanwhile, the other two are. Yay, cheers! I don't know why, but they creep me out. Let's talk about something fun. Something that's common between us. Common between us? But that would be... Mamiya, that's the only subject you all share. Don't go there, Tojo Minato. It's a pitfall. Like, the weather. It's pretty cold lately, isn't it?
It is. It is. It is.
So there was something else. It's cold. Really cold. I can't bring myself to leave the bed. I get what you mean. I just want to give up and sleep in. I'm all naked, so I can't move unless I'm covered in a blanket. Huh? Weird, since the ones surrounding me are naked too. They say people under 20 are like children and have higher body temperatures, so maybe the cold doesn't bother them.
Huh?
Oh dear, are you okay? Did you bring your inhaler? Whose fault do you think this is? Are you okay, Haruki? He's not answering. Is it so bad that you can't talk? Nigaki, you worked in healthcare. What do you think? I'm fine, don't mind me. Morichika, you don't have to say it like that. Like what? Was I too loud? I always laugh so much with the weather conversation, Lamau. What? Huh? It's been so long since I've seen Toma so sad. Can I take a photo? She's seen him like this before? I never did. Wait, making a photo of me and Haruki. Huh? Can I take one too? I'm really good at it. I get the most likes in class. Make sure I look more handsome than Haruki. Though seemingly hanging by a thread, the dinner continued. Oh god. It's still hanging by a thread. It is literally the sword of Damocles over this entire situation. If the topic of Mamiya gets broached, it's gonna drop. Oh, gods. Tojo Minato lowered the camera and gasped, clearly impressed. Looking at you now, you two are very similar. You really are brothers. Well, yeah. Stop mentioning that, it's annoying. Right, it's your family. Guess it's rude of me to talk about it as an outsider. It's fine, Minato. Thanks for being considerate, though. To be honest, it's been so long since we've seen each other that I was a bit worried about meeting him just by myself. It takes guts to spout bullshit like that. See? He gets mad like that, so having you around makes it easier to relax. Really? Looks like it put a strain on you, though. I'm sorry. It's fine. If it helps you, I can handle this much. What a shitty act. Morichika, what's your problem with your brother? He's the one who has a problem with me. He still hasn't forgiven me. See? I just can't clear his misunderstanding. Morichika. Toja Minato. Your family. You'd have way more fun if you got along. Was completely on Morichika Toma's side. The air moved and his position was fixed. Morichika squinted his eyes. I'm leaving. Hey, Morichika, isn't this dinner meant to fix your relationship? Is that how you see it? Couldn't this just as well be a dinner meant to help you get along with Mayuri? Well, it's not like I know what happened between you two. What happened? The silence that followed was almost painful. As Toja Minato searched his mind for an answer, a bell-like voice rang out. Yes, Minato? I want to get along with you. And I don't. Why, no harm in getting along with her, Toja. You're the one who... Hey, Minato. Toja Minato's words were cut short as he froze up. His hand still holding a knife was grasped by a feminine hand. The way she bent forward had the grace of a swan. Looking at her felt like watching a scene from a movie. Here, say ah. In striking contrast to her beauty, she made a coarse gesture. What are you doing? This isn't the kind of place for... Say ah. She brought the meat to his lips, coloring them with the fat and sauce. Then she slowly turned the fork in a circle. The metal opened up a path between his teeth and sealed his movements like a predator catching its prey. Like a snake, she was waiting for Toja Minato to move his mouth on his own. His loud chewing filled the silence as everyone at the table watched on with bated breath. He tried to make it quiet, but their sensitive ears picked it up with ease. When Toja Minato swallowed the food with an audible gulp, Nagaki Mayuri gave him a look like a crescent moon. Well done. Taking her time, she took the fork out of his mouth. You ate it so nicely. Good job, Minato. Following those words, his dried eyes began to quiver. Toja, are you okay? Sorry. Toja! As Minato ran off, Arki immediately gave chase and found him in the bathroom. Nagaki, get away from Minato! Yeah, no kidding! He was cupping water from the sink and rinsing his mouth over and over again. I'm gonna be dirty, I need to wash it out. Are you okay? You're acting weird. Minato looked like he was about to throw up. Arki reached out to rub his back, but... Don't touch me! My bad. What's your relationship with Miss Nagaki? Mayuri? We're buds, I guess. People who've known each other for a long time. What about you? Do you know each other? If you don't, she wouldn't do something that indecent, would she? What's wrong? Nothing. I just can't believe what she did. Oh, I getcha. I'm always left baffled by the weird stuff she does out of nowhere. Man, there's a time and place for everything. It's unfortunate she took a liking to you. Fortunate. Can you walk? Maybe you should ask for some water. It's unfortunate that she took a liking to me? The sound of still flowing water was bothering them. An open window somewhere was letting cold air that chilled their backs in an uncomfortable way. Water was gushing out of the faucet with a disquieting sound. Toja Minato's face in the mirror looked almost like that of a ghost. Someone takes a liking to you and rapes you. Unfortunate is one way to put it. Wait, Toja. Morichika Haruki rushed after Toja Minato, an intense wind was holding him back. What did you mean by that? The thing about words. That once you say them, they can never be taken back, so people are careful about what they say. Despite the strong wind between them, Haruki could hear him clearly. so they don't have any regrets. Talk in a way I can understand. Neither you nor I. Neither of us knew anything. Guess it's no one's fault. Stinging cold blew through the gap. Streetlights lent long shadows to the two emotionless silhouettes. Hold on. I was taken advantage of back when I was in elementary school. The snow that began to fall hid their expressions. His voice was silent and calm, but seemed to condemn the other. A woman held me down by force and, looking back at it, that was probably sexual assault. The wind was so cold, making it inhaling air difficult. The lady who was right there at that dinner table. The snow touched their eyelashes, blurring their vision. She was the one who messed me up when I was little. Oh god, this got so much more twisted. Fuck. Sharp air they inhaled through their noses ravaged their lungs. You didn't know, did you? You knew nothing about my past or her involvement. You didn't know, so I can't exactly blame you for saying something hurtful. It was hard to blink. We all have our hands full with our own pain, as well as that of the people around us. It happens. I tried to use the lighter to escape that torturous gaze. Toji Minato looked at him while he repeatedly tried lighting it with his cold fingers. Not gonna get a flame. Huh? Chick, chick. The sound of the lighter's wheel spinning made an empty sound as it produced a no effect. That lighter's probably broken. Why don't you throw away what's no longer useful to you? That's the kind of person you are, right, Mr. Morichika? Why was she there? He collapsed onto the sofa, ignoring the possibility that he could mess up his formal clothes. Memo on the table was the same as it was when he left. Instead of putting away the key he'd just used, he was gripping it with his shaking hands. I can't escape that person. Minato, drink some water. Mamiya. Finally noticed the gas mask boy straddling the top of the sofa. Take a couple, pour water into it, and drink. Take your time drinking, make each gulp a small one. Thanks. It's late now, let's get ready for bed. Or if I can. Morichika. Next thing he knew, he had said that name. He was a high-handed, easygoing man he didn't quite like. But he was also the first one to find out about Mina's true identity. Why would you say that in front of Toma, Snigaki? Wondered if the trust he had given him was nothing but conceit. I'm so cold. I'll embrace you and warm you. You should all stick a hot shower, though. Thanks, Mamiya. You're the only one who's always nice to me. Ikeda, I'm the only one who will forever be your ally. Yeah, I know. It's not like me to dwell on the past. I'm having fun now, and that's all that matters. Do you wish to give the other party a proper punishment? It's been so long that I don't really know how I feel about it. And honestly, I don't want to remember. He opened the curtains and ran his fingers along the outline of the crescent moon. Also, I have Mina now. That's how I can stay strong. No longer the way I was back then, unable to do anything at all. Fuck. When was the first time Mina was called the Cinderella Maid? Many thought the reason was because her true identity was unnecessary to turn heads at a ball. Then again, it started on the internet, so nobody really knows the details. No, that's exactly how it went. I remember someone posting that in my thread. So that's how it was. Do you not like being called that, Mina? No, it's actually the other way around. I like that name a lot. Cinderella, the person who magically transformed into someone beautiful. I feel like it fit me just right. Mina didn't need a prince. She just wanted to dance with everyone else on a never-ending ball. Glad Mina exists. That past doesn't mean anything. Mina and I will grow stronger together. Oh no, I'll be late. Why didn't you tell me about the time? My senses are telling me you shouldn't go today. It's my part-time job. I gotta hurry. Amiya. Today's shift was a busy one. Ooh, that was a close call. I just barely made it. It's not that cold today. I don't need a coat. Really? Take this then. Good luck. After being given a bunch of flyers, Mina hurried through the familiar town of Akihabara, her boots making loud footsteps. Their cafe was a place that aimed to be casual and basic at the same time, so the amount of flyers was just enough to give out to those who were interested. Besides, Mina standing there was a form of advertisement in itself. That was the manager's perspective anyway. It was complicated, but it didn't change what Mina would do. Work for the cafe. Hello, we're open today as well. Mina, are you at the cafe today? Yes, we're planning services for the evening, and there's going to be an event, too. I guess I'll go then. Can I have a flyer? Sure, thank you. I'll be looking forward to your visit. After seeing off the man as he walked away with a smile, Mina returned to her usual place. Hey, look, is it really true? That was when Mina realized she was being looked at. This was hardly unusual, but the gazes made her feel like she was being evaluated, which made her break out in a nervous sweat. She had to focus on the job right now. Hello, we'll be waiting for your return, Master. Can I have a flyer too? Yes, of course. Thank you. That is a wonderful uniform. Why are you... What's wrong, Miss Maid? Oh, nothing. No. In this moment, he wasn't Toji Minato. She was Mina. It's just a coincidence that she passed by. Mina had to get through this. Well, look at the time. I gotta get back to the cafe. Don't run away, Minato. Why? Are you calling me that while I'm wearing this? Avoiding crowds, Mina ran into a complex back alley and took a breather. She was sweating all over, and the apron dress that she liked so much was feeling awfully heavy. I gotta get back. Found you. The flyer she'd been holding slipped out of her weakened hands and danced in the wind. The breeze picked them up and threw them around as if creating a barrier between Mina and the woman. Oh, God. Nagaki, get away from Minato! Get away from Minato! Mina's a cute name. Did you come up with it yourself? Why are you... A woman who seemed like she didn't belong in Akihabara, Nagaki Mayuri, continued to talk as she looked at the flyer. Yeah, come on, don't be mad, Mina. You'll wrinkle that charming face of yours. She couldn't figure this woman out. Where are you planning to go? Her long, slender arms pushed her against the wall. Why not quit working at this cafe right now? Huh? Come to my place, Mina. If you've lots of money, you'll be able to do whatever you want there. What do you say? Why would you say that? What are you after? Doing it because you're cute. Hey, we're kind of similar, don't you think? Huh? I also work at a place because of Nagaki. I was called Nina. I danced in front of many guests again and again, over and over. Nina was popular too. She spent every night laughing just like you. I would never sell my womanhood. Really? But you're actually selling those looks, aren't you? Maid uniforms seemed to become even heavier. It's not what I never meant to. Why would she say something so mean? Because we're so similar that I'm telling you to come to my place, Mina. Be able to use it freely. Mess it up if you want. I refuse. Oh. The wine-colored eyes, decorated by long eyelashes, slowly traced her silhouette. Are you sure? Might not be able to work there anymore. What do you mean? The woman's breath was next to Mina's ear as she ran her fingers through her hair. Stop. Some would see this as pleasant, but how? Sorry, but I won't. As their eyes locked, Gaki pushed her lips against hers. Stop. Cute clothes, cute face, cute lips. You're so cute. What if society finds out that you're a liar? What do you think will happen, Minato? It's got nothing to do with you. Nothing to do with me, really. You do see how similar we are, don't you? Minato wondering why she was forcing him to listen to all this confusing stuff. I'm really sorry, Minato. Your Mina is in the way. Mina ran off in desperation. She felt like she had to run away as quickly as possible. Isn't that Mina? She silently begged them. She pled them not to look at her, rather him. Don't look at me. Mina rushed to the back door of the maid cafe and caught her breath. She'd run here out of desperation to escape anyone who could see her. Right now, she wondered why she had believed the cafe would be the right destination. Huh? With her voice trembling, one of the girls Mina worked with called her name. Looking at an email displayed on a PC monitor. Are you sure? Might not be able to work there anymore. It said, Mina's true identity is Toji Minato, a male student. Attached with several sneak photos of Toji Minato. Everything that Mina was desperately trying to hide had been laid bare for all the world to see. Sorry for deceiving you all. Mina grasped the apron dress, desperately trying not to tremble. She was fully expecting them to be disappointed, reject her, and eliminate this place that Mina loved so much where she belonged. Hey, please look up. The voice that followed was far more gentle than Mina had imagined. I really like you, Mina. When we're here, we take on cute maid names, but when we're home, we go back the way we normally are, right? Back at home, I eat potato chips in my bed. Not very maid-like, huh? My dad gets mad at me for it, so I've never told anyone. What about you? Did that make you hate me? Of course not. Right now, you're Kanan, the same as ever. See? We're no different. Sorry, but to me, your sex just doesn't matter all that much. Just like you don't know everything about me, I didn't know everything about you. Still, I've always liked everything about Mina and respected her a lot. As Mina looked around in bewilderment, a few of them gently embraced her. This didn't change that. Can I stay here? Will you accept me? What kind of question is that? Of course I will. Might be some mean people out there, but we're on your side. If they're mean to you, it would count as an obstruction of business, wouldn't it? We'd just call the police. Well, so much. Such gentle and understanding people. The feeling of the floaty apron on Mina's skin was now a source of relief. However, the discomfort in her heart had yet to vanish. You know, a moment. The other girls might say that, but since you faked your identity, I can't just put you back to work right away. Understand. I'll have to put you on disciplinary leave, is that okay? Thank you. I'm deeply sorry for the trouble I caused. Preparing to end work as she usually would, Mina changed in the bathroom. It's Nagaki's problem with me. Would she expose Mina? I wonder why. It's the other way around. It's everything until now that's been abnormal. The girl in the nurse uniform drew really close and started whispering next to his neck. You're hiding your true self, fooling everyone around you. Okay. Here, take a good look. Tiny finger pointed into the distance. Minato looked up. There were many people beyond the window. Huh? Ian is a guy, that's a shocker. Some people were saddened or even angered by the reveal. Why would a crossdresser be at a normal maid cafe? He could have worked at a place that specialized in that kind of thing. I don't care if it's a guy or a girl, but making money by fooling people is just not right. Some were critical of Mina for lying. In this day and age, it's more unusual to let this kind of thing bother you. Hell, I'm a Mina fan now. Now that I look at this video, that's clearly a guy's physique. I'm impressed by all the effort he put into looking so cute so he could do what he liked. Others were just onlookers who said whatever they felt like saying. This is your debt? That's not true. There's people who understand me. That's enough too. That's enough. Is it really? You're a greedy one, aren't you? Didn't you want to have everyone's approval? Aye, but that's impossible. You can't please everyone. Indeed, it's impossible. There's been something impossible about your existence since the very beginning. This is a debt you brought on yourself, so don't look away. Make sure you pay the price. Only you'd kept yourself forever under control. Then you wouldn't have sullied Mina. Since you were so greedy, the cute little Mina became a cross-dressing man. Give her back. Give back our Mina. For people to be stronger and shine brighter than one normally could. Required faith. Longing. By turning into the subject of people's ideals, one could become powerful beyond everyday limits. Mina was shining brighter than anyone else in this town. When he became the subject of faith, Toji Minato. He knew better than anyone else that the Mina everyone had been looking at was a false image. However, that was all fine. But the source of her power, the fans, they believed in that false image from the bottom of their hearts. That's why I didn't want anyone to break it. Even if everyone around me accepted it. If people found out I was Mina, my image would be broken. His mouth was sour, his head was sour, his ears were sour, his fingers were sour. Nagaki Mayuri's icy chuckle kept ringing out in his head over and over again. The floor of the bathroom he hit seemed to deny his entire existence. If only I was born purely as Mina. In that case, nothing would have been broken. The lack of oxygen made him feel like his brain was being pulled upwards. Tied up, it was being strangled and squeezed of its fluids. Time can never be turned back. He crawled on the floor and sobbed. Broken snow globe can never be fixed. When he finally got back home, there was no one there. He got his phone and saw lots of contact notifications from his classmates. Wondered what could have made them contact him today. Did they also find out? I don't care what they say about me. I'll be sad if they can't understand it, but I'll do what I can to stay tough. Mina. I wanted to be her. I wanted her to be someone everyone could believe in. There's been something impossible about your existence since the very beginning. I wonder how you'd feel if you were here. Natsumi. How would you have looked at me, or Mina? He poured strength into his clenched fist. I see. All right, Natsumi. He smiled, as seeing his own reflection in the phone's dark screen. When was the first time Mina was called the Cinderella Maid? And he thought the reason was because her true identity was unnecessary to turn heads at a ball. Cinderella, a person who magically transformed into someone beautiful. But in the end, it's a story about just Cinderella. The clock hit midnight, the magic was undone. Gotta kill her, don't I? That's how I should repay my debt, right? Because at school were more or less what he had expected. Morning. Morning. Those who used to cheerfully greet him weren't even looking him in the eye now. As he walked towards his seat, he heard some light laughter behind him. Hey, look. They are similar, but seriously, Tojo? Keeping a smile, he somehow made it to his seat. He was acting tough, but his chin was trembling slightly. His teeth were uncontrollably chattering as well. Indeed, society post-reveal was more or less what he'd expected. He was subjected to the embarrassment, loneliness, and punishment that he'd imagined. It's not like I'd be hurt for a complete stranger if a complete stranger said something bad about me. They can say whatever they want, so I'll do the same. I can't handle it as well as Morichika. I feel like there's no point if the people in my class fail to understand me. And even now, I still like them all. Can't just start hating them because they don't understand. Nato. Standing a short distance away, his childhood friend called out to him. Ryo, what's up? I'll be on roof during lunch break. What's this about? A bit busy, so I don't think I can make it. Nato. See ya. It's really awkward and nice. But I don't want you to find out the truth and have you look at me like the others do. It's not that I don't believe in him. But I can't be sure until the moment comes. And if someone wasn't prejudiced, it was impossible to predict how they would react. Someone close to them coming out like this. Please stay clueless. Even if Ryo left the gray zone, I'd be cursing even my childhood. Nagaki Mayuri, why did you do this? Unable to hold back, I visited Nagaki Mayuri's home. When I opened the door, I was approached and cornered by a bunch of girls. What did someone send you? Why is the security not working? Any of you creep, get out. Eek. Are you one of Mina's fans? Nagaki Mayuri showed herself, wearing a cold smile. Yes! Why did you expose Mina? You simply revealed the truth. The truth that Mina was living in a fake world. Why did you feel the need to do that? Nagaki Mayuri's expression remained the same when met with Natsumi's frustrated question. Why did you feel bad for the fans that believed in her? Imagine if they themselves found out that the one they believed in was a fake. Mina isn't fake. Her sex doesn't matter. I can still support... I wonder how many fans are like you and continue to cheer her on like before. Gaki Mayuri brought her fingertips close and caressed my chin. You just blushed, didn't you? It's because I'm of the opposite sex, right? The idol industry is nothing but a business selling so-called pseudo-love. He You loved yours. You yourself loved Mina to some extent, didn't you? I stuck between her words and the sensation of her fingers. I was left utterly lost and confused. Why was I obsessed with Mina? Her dance skills? Or was it her appearance and personality that dragged me in? Gaki Miyuri, as if seeing through my confusion, whispered in my ear. Should I become a new Mina? A new Mina? Yes, your perfect idol. This world has no convenient people who would play the role of your ideal for you. But with me, that is possible. Her gentle hand caressed my cheek. But in exchange, I want you to swear loyalty to me. The girls surrounding her fixed their gazes on me. That is the rule. Idols have rules, after all. Understood this place was a fan community centered around Nagaki Mayuri. I knew that her sweet words were deeply attracted to me as an idol fan. Well, what do you say? I won't give up on Mina. I won't give in to your smooth talk. I'll never do it. Even though you broke Mina, I will bring her back. Just like that, I slapped her arm away and left. Oh dear. You don't even realize that's exactly what hurts Minato so much. It's cold. I wonder if Ryo's waiting for me, not knowing that I left early. Felt like he did something bad. Colorless clouds above rolled in, looking like they were about to fall. The river he hated so much was flowing louder than usual. This muddled, dirty water wasn't needed in a clean world. There's probably nothing to eat at home. I should buy something, and before he could finish his sentence with go home, his leg stopped. He realized he wasn't even hungry. He also wasn't in the mood to go home. He also didn't have the courage to say I'm home to an empty house. He had none of that. Nothing at all. Wonder why? The river roared as it flowed. The sound of the river he hated so much ringed in his ears, coiling about. Mixed with himself, whom he also hated. Nato. Why do you always come when I don't want you to? He could try and run away. But if his shoulder was grabbed with him in his current state, it would be hard for him to shake it off. He got worried and couldn't sit still. Oh, so you knew about Mina. Your parents. They're not internet savvy, so they probably don't know. Then again, I have girls' clothes in my room, so it's possible they already know. That's not what I'm asking. Are they at home tonight? Or at the hospital? What of it? Silver that had begun falling from the sky at some point appeared at the edge of his vision. Hey. If you don't mind, you can come to my place. The sweet words made him doubt his ears. You still think I'm a child after doing after school stuff? I'm already treating you as an equal, and I'm still worried. Sorry about what happened at that dinner. I didn't intend to ruin it and hurt you. I also didn't mean to make you meet Nagaki. That's the last name I want to hear right now. It's okay, you don't have to force yourself to deal with me either. Also, I still have... Mamiya, he wanted to say. Before he knew it, he was clinging to Toma's arm. Hey. Why did you picture Toma while thinking about Mamiya? Sorry, I felt like I was gonna fall. His blue purplish eyes, half hidden by a smile, gently waited for his words. I see. Glad you didn't. Why did Minato feel such an overwhelming sense of relief with him? Can I come over to your place? He didn't want to trust him, but he still wanted to be close to him. Yes, of course. So you'll finally become empty. His voice disappeared into the snow, now falling heavier than before. Oh boy, this isn't good. This really isn't good. Okay. Shit, pick up, dammit. Archika Haruki became more and more irritated while holding a phone that displayed the name Tojo on its screen. Called him numerous times since the dinner, but he just wasn't answering. No chance I'd throw you away. Haruki sulked and muttered that as he turned the key of his motorbike. The main cafe had a large crowd of people in front of it, which seemed unusual. It's a popular place, but he didn't think it was the kind of store people would crowd around in such a disorderly fashion. What's this about? A poster up front briefly announced that Mina would go on a hiatus. Came all the way and Mina's not even in? Turns out the Cinderella Maid was just Cinderella after all. That's what tons of people online were saying anyway. Cinderella? Mina was just a hell of a swindling crook. Huh? He's not at work. It's about time he'd be leaving school. Hey.
Yep.
Where's Tojo? Excuse me? I'm asking where Tojo is. Who? Students, clearly terrified, passed him by while avoiding his gaze. I guess not everyone knows him. I wonder if there's anyone else. What do you want? Huh? As Haruki looked around, he was approached by a tanned boy.
Eek.
I'm asking what you want from Minato. Called him by his name. This was the guy Haruki wanted. So you know him. Don't answer my question with a question. I'm asking what you want from him. We gotta talk, he and I. Man furrowed his well-defined eyebrows and glared at him. You the one who caused all this? Huh? You the one who drove him to the brink? His amber eyes were full of direct hostility to Morichika Haruki. The intensity was such that you could feel it on the skin. No one could even approach. He had been through his fair share of scuffles, and his senses now told him this was bad news. This man was dangerous. Fighting him wouldn't end well. I don't know what you mean. I just want to see him. Is he really that down right now? You're not the one who spread something about him, right? What are you talking about? Minato wasn't in today. That's so. Thanks. Didn't come to school? That ain't like him. Neither you nor I. Neither of us knew anything, so I guess it was no one's fault. The aftertaste of that night had yet to leave him. What about Natsumi's death, man? You're the one with the phone. Maybe we should actually give it back to Natsumi's family. You said we'd go give it back to them. What's the point of doing that by yourself? He was on the way to his motorbike in the parking lot before the station. Ah. Within the crowd, he spotted a dark, roundish head. What? He wanted to apologize for what happened. He wanted to go back to the way things were. Hey, Tojo. Toma. The joyous voice, Tojo Minato ran to someone else. Haruki couldn't believe his eyes. Did I keep you waiting? It must have been cold. Fine. You carry that stuff and let's go home. He stopped hearing anything. The voices of the pair became distant as they walked off. He couldn't even pick up the noises of the crowd. The only thing ringing in his head was his own heartbeat and breathing. His hands were shaking. Was it because of the falling rain? He wasn't able to say anything beyond that. He stopped that cursed word from coming out by putting his hand over his mouth. He stood in place and crouched down until his ragged breathing evened out. He didn't talk to me, but he did talk to him, huh? Wondered why he could never have what he wanted. Go ahead and stay a loser your whole life. Wondered why he was always left with nothing. About Minato. As he was overcome by pain, a voice like candy tickled his ear. He said he doesn't want to talk to you again. That's so. If I can't have something, I should have broken it while I had the chance. His guts felt as cold about as something lifeless. He hardly wanted to puke it all out. It should all disappear with poor old me. I somehow got Toma to go home without me. He didn't notice anything. Hope he likes the snow globe I bought him in secret. Wonder if he still remembers the story of the treasure island he once told me. It's raining harder, I should hurry back. Yo. Archika. What are you up to? I hear you skipping school. His cold, faint purple eyes made Tojo Minato's face turn pale. It's got nothing to do with you, Mr. Morichika. Mr. Morichika, huh? His eyebrows twisted slightly, and the next moment he grabbed Tojo Minato's wrist. Stop. What? As he moved, the mixed scent of perfume and tobacco danced around him. It was more than strong enough to stop Tojo Minato's thoughts. Started it. Started what? You're the one who opened up to me first. So why are you building walls between us now? His voice coming straight from the heart caused a brief silence. They could only hear ragged breathing and the sound of rain. Aren't you satisfied? Huh? Mina's gone. The liar's been defeated. Isn't that enough? Hold on, what are you talking about? I'll live quietly without troubling the rest of society, so no one's telling you to do that. They are, though. They're all saying it. Who's they? Just tell me what's going on. They could, but it's not like you get how people feel. Please just forget about me. Catching Haruki off guard, and Minato tried to shake off the hand grabbing his wrist. Stop that shit. You... If only it wasn't raining. The place they were standing wasn't so wet. During their little struggle, Tojo Minato was driven near the stairs. He gathered his strength to push him away. He slipped. His outstretched arm wasn't long enough to catch Tojo Minato. The boy fell down the stairs head first. Tojo! Hey, Tojo, hey! The ambulance he called came in a snap, and Tojo Minato was quickly taken to the hospital. He didn't seem to be bleeding, but he wasn't waking up even after a few hours had passed. Marachika Haruki was overcome by a sense of unease so severe he nearly screamed as he waited for Tojo to wake up. No. You're not gonna get a flame. You didn't need for this to happen. Don't throw away what's no longer useful. Don't you throw away what's no longer useful to you? That's the kind of person you are, right, Mr. Morishika? Wanted to apologize to you. Minato. The door was quickly opened as an aged man and woman rushed in. With Tojo Minato's parents, how is he? He's still not waking up. Haruki couldn't look them in the face. Minato went on to lose his life like Natsumi. Sorry, able to find the right words, he simply looked down. Here he saw Tojo Minato's eyebrows move slightly. Sorry. Minato. Slowly opened his eyes and looked around. Tojo. Why am I here? Fell down the stairs and lost consciousness. I'm so glad you're okay. Mom, Dad. Making a big deal out of nothing, huh? Wait, are you crying? He's even articulating his words properly. Tojo Minato rubbed his mother's back as if nothing happened. Joe. Erky's voice was quaking so much it seemed almost exaggerated. Until he wanted to face his mistake, so he gathered his courage and took a step forward. Glad you woke up. Wanted to apologize and start over. I'm sorry for what I... Who are you? Silence callously pierced the space between them. This isn't the time for jokes, Tojo. Look, I'm sorry, but I really don't know who you are. Tojo Minato shook his head, his eyes full of bewilderment and disbelief. Let's start all over, right? Even with the Mina thing, you and I. Mina? Who's that? Minato was diagnosed with systemic amnesia. Type of dissociative amnesia. Mental stress he'd built up seemed to have been pushed to the limit by the organic damage to the brain. Lost all memories related to Morachika Haruki and Mina the Maid. Having forgotten two major sources of stress, Tojo Minato spoke to his parents with a joyful smile on his face. Turns out the rumors that he's going out with Kashiwagi from Class A are true. Huh? Minato isn't single anymore? That's a shocker. I'm impressed Kashiwagi confessed to him. I mean, Tojo is... Let's not talk about that anymore. I mean, Minato's really happy right now. Welcome back, Toma. I'm back, Minato. Can I stay here again today? My parents have night shifts, and Mom said she'd worry less if I were with you, so I wasn't alone. Why not go out to eat today? Are we going to that Italian place you mentioned? I was really looking forward to that. It had been a while since Tojo Minato showed a smile bursting with this much joy. Forgetting about Marachika Haruki and Mina made him more cheerful than before. The smile he wore was so natural that after he returned to school, everyone in class simply left the cross-dressing thing of the past. No one called him Mina, and he didn't remember anything about her. This is for the best. I side-eyed Tojo Minato as he was happily eating pizza with Morachika Toma. There's nothing to worry about here. My friend was happy and was accompanied by an adult he trusted. Wasn't this exactly what I wanted? This may have come at the cost of Mina vanishing from the world, but... After he got closer to Morachika Toma, Mia started to subside. My friends weren't clinging to fiction. They continued to exist in a world full of real people. Everything was as it had been before Natsumi died. Why won't it open? Tojo Minato stood before the closet. He put his hand on the door, but then stopped. Oh, I lost the key, didn't I? I'll just check it during spring cleaning or something. Well, I wonder what I was hiding in here. Minato, you're awful. Found himself with a red hand-shaped mark on his face. First girlfriend he had in a while had blatantly dumped him. I mean, she's the one who started it by saying all that strange stuff. Cross-dressing? What a mean accusation. Still, I guess I may have hurt her. Where is Mina now? Well, who even is Mina? He shook his head and began walking, only to immediately stop in place. Where am I supposed to go? The river flowing below was louder and more annoying than usual. It felt like that muddy river was consuming him, taking and mixing everything. Where do I? The outlines, common sense, even the air itself. Everything felt like it had ended. I needed to walk as if running from that incessant noise. Home. I gotta get back home, and yet... Mia. Really, you? Gojo Minato didn't hear those words. Why would he? His name wasn't Mumia, after all. There's no mistaking it. You are Mumia, aren't you? I certainly didn't know this man. Huh?
What?
Why was Toji Minato having an encounter with Samajima Satoru? I've wanted to see you for so long. Come, some friends who've been looking for you are waiting at a particular house. Hold on, you've got the wrong person. Hey! Minato tried to twist his arm to shake off Samajima's hand, but this man was a police officer. Minato's black belt meant little against him, and the boy living in 2012 passed through the door to the house from the year 1999. Truly are Mumia. Stop this already. I know about the being called Mumia, but it isn't me. You certainly seem to resemble Mumia in certain ways, but my Mumia is cuter. My Mumia is sexier. Can I punch you? Anyway, I'm leaving. To go where? Where? My house. If you know Mumia, then you also belong in this house. We won't let you go anywhere. Samajima Satoru's long arms prevented Toji Minato from leaving. The moment he was overcome by instinctual fear, the door was opened with great intensity. What are you all doing? Miss Nikaki. A beautiful girl now stood between Samajima and Tojo. She was completely overwhelmed by shock and bewilderment. Oh my, welcome back. You're basically bullying a weakling. Stop it. You're a policeman, so don't act like a criminal. Why? His long-standing symbol of fear had appeared before him as a person his own age. What's all this commotion? Mumia? And you're... Are you Toma? Yeah, but did Mumia really come back? You're gonna call me that too? That's not my name. I'm Minato, and... Minato, no, I don't remember anyone like that. Sorry. Oh, no. Mayuri, you think this could be the Mumia we're looking for? What do you think? Mumia. Him? She looked at him with her large eyes, making her shoulders tremble. Might have been just a moment, but it seemed like she was gauging him for eternity. You're nothing like him. Leave! Nagaki Mayuri turned away and disappeared into her room, sulking. Sorry for being so forceful. You're a student as well, right? I'm curious about the Mumia thing too, but for now you should go home. Wait, Toma. Tell me about this being you call Mumia and explain this whole situation. Not good at, that good at talking. But I want you to speak. I want to hear it from you. Alright, it might take a while though. So that house is a place where people came together to talk about an illusion called Mumia. No, Mumia actually existed. He just disappeared one day. Toji Minato looked on in bewilderment as Toma, sitting on a swing, glanced down at the ground. Behind him, there was the Mumia dressed as a conductor standing with muddy feet. You're kind of similar. No, that's it. Similar. You said your name is Tojo. Did you have any siblings? A twin, maybe? I'm an only child, though I had a vanishing twin. A twin who wasn't born. A vanishing twin? Yeah. I'm the twin brother of a sibling who disappeared while we were in our mother's womb. But that... As he considered how to continue, he was overcome by a dizzying headache. Felt as though his defense mechanisms were preventing him from remembering. Wouldn't that be Mumia? Huh? Yeah, I imagine Arasagawa would say something similar. Lost twin could have been the place where our Mumia should have existed. Oh, my twin is... The other me is...
What did that twin look like again? Welcome back, Minato. Ah, Toma, you're an adult again. Huh? What do you mean?
Toma tilted his head in confusion. Kojo had many questions, but he chose to relax for now. But yeah, I brought some casual clothes for you.
Thanks, I actually considered buying some myself, let's see.
Figured it would suit you. Gave him a green hoodie and a school uniform.
Is this? You put it on?
The hoodie was one thing, but Minato didn't know what to think of using a school uniform as casual wear. However, the moment he glanced up, he saw Toma looking at him with a serious expression. It seemed as though he was brooding over something really difficult.
Wouldn't that be Mumia?
Mia?
Is this Mumia's...
No, forget I said... I think you would say that name by yourself. Those words, Toma pushed Minato against the wall.
Gah.
Malicious smile on the adult's face and the pressure against his back made Minato feel like his chest was being crushed.
Why are you doing this?
Because you're just like Mumia.
Have you been using me all this time?
Since the moment we met, were you nice to me because you just wanted something from me?
Using you, that's an awful way to put it.
You were attracted to me yourself, weren't you? Marchika Toma put on a prideful smile. His well-featured face suddenly came close to Minato's. He stopped right before they were close enough to kiss.
Right?
I don't like this. This isn't like you, Toma.
Hey, don't cry. Keep it together.
Come on, put it on and try being Mumia. Something that looked like a blue fire burned deep within Morishika Toma's eyes. His gaze made Minato's heart pound intensely with fear.
Stop, that's not me. I won't become Mumia.
Stop resisting. Why are you so mad anyway? Minato turned pale as his verbal resistance turned out to be ineffective.
Oh, God. This poor man can't stop but be sexually assaulted.
No matter who he tries to run to for comfort. The only person who has treated him with kindness is Haruki. And he can't even remember Haruki. That's what makes this so fucking twisted.
What exactly was Toma seeing in him? Minato had to understand what he was saying.
Understanding, his thoughts were operating at an immense speed, dragged both the past and the present down. Toji Minato came to an understanding.
Toma, why do you look like you're on the brink?
He subconsciously said those words. His own will wasn't involved. His body acted by itself. Looked at Toma's confused face and grabbed him by the chest. That moment, Toji Minato became another entity.
Let's turn it all into a joke.
Eyes like those of a wild beast pierced Morishika Toma. Became immobile as if enchanted by a spell. Move. Minato pushed Toma aside and ran. Man left behind looked at his back dumbfounded. I knew I wasn't wrong. Minato, you are my Mumia. Poor Minato. Toji Minato kept on running without even knowing why. Every step filled his chest with unease. He didn't know why he acted like a madman there. It certainly wasn't something he wanted to do. But he could. He could, so it was hard to find a way not to. He let out that groan. He felt anger towards himself. He found himself to be extremely pathetic. Like acting. I want to use my empathetic abilities to their fullest and fulfill people's ideals. He didn't know who he was or where he was meant to run. He continued to run, hoping to grasp something to play some role. The night breeze carried a chill as a silver light shone into the back alley where Toma was. He was reclining on the wall and slightly hanging his head. However, he was smiling maliciously. It seemed like a dark reflection of his goals. Why would you drive him to the brink like that?
What's so bad about this?
The silhouette reflected by the silver light filled me with irritation. Saying it's lacking in sincerity towards him.
Sincerity?
Sincerity, huh? Morishika Toma gently swung a hat as he smiled.
I heard about this from Nagaki.
He was called Mina and performed like an idol role, didn't he?
Yeah.
In that case, Mina's fans are guilty of the same thing I am. I couldn't agree with that answer. You look like you want to argue, but I'm not wrong. Minato was simply playing the role of Mumina. Scarcely different than playing the role of Mumia. Toji Minato willingly plays the role of Mina, and nobody forced him into it. Fans project their own ideals onto their idols, don't they? Oh boy. Surrounded by the howling wind, Tomo put on a cold smile. That's the secret behind why idols shine so bright, isn't it? That's... Gusts of wind seemed to cut into his skin. You're attracted to Minato's charm yourself, aren't you? I raised my face as if startled. Don't you think we're pretty much the same? Not like you. No, we're definitely not the same. So you weren't attracted to Mina? Migaki Miyuri's words came back to mind. You yourself loved Mamiya to some extent. Sorry, loved Mina to some extent, didn't you? I fell silent and was left alone, unable to do anything but hang my head. I feel so pathetic. I don't even have the right to meet you, Toji Minato. Bit my lip as the cold sunk into my body. Guilt burning in my heart was scorching my body. What's up, Minato? Sorry for visiting without prior notice. I was able to remember where your place was, at least. I don't mind that. Well, come in, can I? Thanks. Huh? Where's Midori? She went out to look for rocks. Wait, so we missed each other? Man, I came here to see her. Did you really? Huh? His childhood friend was sharp as he looked. The question made Minato's hair stand up. I just thought maybe you came to see me. I was kind of hoping. Come on now. Of course I wanted to see you too. I don't have to sulk like that. Not. Really not. A rush of relief in his heart made Minato poke his friend. He said again and again that I'd hear you out. I'm always grateful for that. Happy as long as you cheer up and go back to your usual place. Back? Kashiwagi had said something similar. It came as a bit of a shock to him, but when he'd come back to school, he'd realized once again that he truly liked her. What do you mean? I just had an accident and took a few days off. I mean, that's it, right? If that's how you look at it, then everything's fine. You don't want to talk about it with me then, huh? Now, there's absolutely nothing I'm hiding from you. But I go way back, don't we? Way back. Not to wonder what he looked like in the past. Gotta get back home. That's so? But I don't know the way. My mind went blank and I kind of forgot where I live. That's why I came here. I actually tried to... It's all good. I remember the way to your place. You see, I'm glad to have you, and I've got the key, right? Huh? Touched his collar and realized the weight and sensation that was supposed to be there was gone, making him turn pale. Huh? What? Why? Nato, what's wrong? This is bad, Ryo. This is really bad. Calm down. What's wrong? This is really bad. I lost the key. Kept it so close. It told me I couldn't lose it, so I had it on me, but... His nose wrinkled up as he lost his sense of balance and couldn't tell how big his body was anymore. What do I do? I can't go home without a key. How long? Will I have to wait until Mom and Dad come back again? I can't go back home. Ryo, what do I... Find it. As Minato crouched down in despair, Ryo gently embraced him. It's all good. He's back, just like he would his sisters. Wait for them with you at the entrance. You can't, you need to get back home. Not in elementary school anymore. Huh? I actually have a part-time job at night too. Try not to tell the school though. Yeah, I didn't know that. That's why I'm not scared of the night. Oh, you're amazing. Don't tell anyone, it'd be bad if the school found out. Words he'd usually never say made Ryo flash a smile. Let's check all the places you've been to in the morning. All over the place today, like there's like no chance we'd find it. How often do you think I deal with Midori's absurd demands? Ryo is such a good friend. Yes, indeed. A key with a flashy string will be easier to find than a four-leaf clover. I've always been so cool. Also, we're not children anymore, Minato. We don't hang our kings on our necks. Minato did as told and looked in his bag where he easily found the key. Thought we'd always be like we were during childhood. Back then, I felt like nothing would ever change. Those olden days of gentle warmth. We visited countless places, talked a lot, and spent many a season together. What's important about you hasn't changed one bit since then. They were just close and distant enough to have a relationship that lasted a long, long time. Something I know all too well. back, Minato. Mom, I'm back, and... Sorry, I bet I gotta go right away. It's been a while, Ryo. You sure have grown. Thanks. Would you like to come in and have something to eat? This man here has a healthy appetite, so I always end up making too much. Oh, come on. You eat with us if you'd like. Can I go pick up Midori, then? They were soon joined by Minato's father, and the five of them enjoyed a meal together. Is it just me, or do you two come home early these days?
Of course we do. We're worried about you.
Well, your jobs give us some time off. We really should have done this earlier. Maybe it's a good thing I hit my head. Come on, don't say that. So I'm happy we get to have a meal and watch variety shows like this. I see. It's all thanks to you. I feel like I finally come back home. I think we're gonna end it there for the night. This entire route has been a trip so far. It looks like we've got maybe two more chapters in this route, but I actually do have to go. I have stuff I have to do here at home. And I am exhausted. So, let's see if anyone's available for a raid. Casper Grimshaw. Alright, we're gonna go raid Casper. Casper is one of my close acquaintances. I wouldn't call him a friend yet, but I am subscribed to his Twitch channel. So let me... He's playing Soul Calibur 6, so this is gonna be fun. Alright. See you folks later. Go raid Casper. Casper is one of my close acquaintances. I wouldn't call him a friend yet, but I am subscribed to his Twitch channel. He's playing Soul Calibur 6.